JT and I have talked about it before. Like, these guys, they lack, like, racecraft. They just know how to pin it. Because I think you grew up on these riding facilities. You wake up in the morning. It's watered. It's groomed.
Yeah, it's a track because you have to ride like this.
You race four times a year. You race Loretta's, Mammoth, whatever. And when you get on with 40 guys on a rough track, you're a little bit lost.
Well, Loretta's is the only time they really race 20-minute motos. So. Yeah.
But do you agree with me, though, a little bit? Do you agree with these kids?
Yeah, I would definitely agree.
But especially when you consider your upbringing, which is, you know, out in the middle of Florida.
It's not the rider's fault. It's the way the races are and the way they prep the tracks for practice and other races. Same thing local race when you're 80cc guy in France. Even at the races don't prep. So it's dusty, it's rocky. So you have to ride like this. You know, here to be fast and win as a amateur American kid, you have to be take outside. And pin it.
And do they ever rev the shit out of their bikes? Yeah. They all rev
and then,
the
and
shit
then basically
out of their
we raised, you know, they end up being super fast, like Borsche or even Baguette. Look at Baguette, how he rode in 250s. Wide open, and then he did
it. It's back up.
You know, wide open, and then around the track, outside, because that's the way you have to ride to be a successful amateur rider.
You know, when I was growing up, not to talk about old days.
Here we go.
We have to.
Hey, actually, Timmy raced against Rick Johnson, JMB, Jeff Ward.
Rick Johnson?
Michael,
no.
Chad Reed,
Jeff Ward, too.
No way.
Yeah.
RJ.
In Japan, yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Oh, 16.
I raced that's Guy badass. Cooper, Matejzevic, like old guys, like 94.
But when I was growing up.
I raced Tim Ferry, David Villeman, Jeremy McGrath.
He's still racing. We actually did not ever, I never ever once as a amateur, like paid money to go through a gate to ride a prep track.
Yeah.
We basically only rode natural,
whatever was in the field.
Was same. In the field.
Right. Yeah. You're
and it was
probably
rough,
same.
Rough, rough.
You had kangaroos going everywhere.
Yeah. We just had a track, like literally like in Australia, like when you got all the big bushes and like the you know the power lines, we would just make tracks underneath the power lines because it was all cleared out and
like going, no one's living there.
Going a little bit off subject, it goes to what I've been saying forever: is you guys supercross track, they're too nice, too new. It's like we need to go back to shitty Corona where you know how to use the throttle and find the traction. Like Florida tracks, you show up at the Nest, the thing is like.
Yeah.
I almost want to ride
two compounds, not quite that.
Evan's probably on you, Dad. It's the water. It's the grass isn't cut.
Yeah, truck's too rough.
It's
if there's two ruts, well, there's a bobcat. They fix it. Then they go to St. Louis
it's not
or,
like us.
Or shitty no, trucks.
We usually leave ours.
Yeah, out two tracks. Like we.
I'm not an insider. I was at the Nest for a while.
It was new all the time.
It was new every day.
Yeah.
I hated it. And then you see all the videos, it's all new. Back a few years ago with Bubba, he rode on a choker cake
I think
every time.
James has been probably the gnarliest dude to come out of that era. You know, like with growing up with really smooth tracks all the time, you know. Like he was, like, I mean, he was obviously badass at motocross and he never really suffered from that. But
all right, let's get some more phone calls. Billy wants to talk about Atlanta 2011. What's up, Billy? How are you?
Hi. Chad Reed, I got to call you out a little bit. That Atlanta pass, I was there in 2011, and that was the worst pass you've ever seen.
Just hang up on this dude.
DV disagrees.
Hang up. Hang up.
DV.
You know what? You know. Stop watching Supercross and pick up another sport. Pick up golf or tennis.
No, I've raced, and I love motocross, Supercross. That's my passion. It's my love. Obviously, never at the level you guys are. But, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and pretend that was a good pass. That was not a good pass. I'm not a Stewart lover either, by the way.
Do you think Wyndham's pass on DV was...
No, he thinks it's great. It was great.
I don't remember that. I have to look that one up.
Oh, okay.
I'm only 24, so I don't...
All right. Thanks, Billy. Appreciate
it. Earlier
one, back in Res Day, that was just called normal. That was Bradshaw.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I would call it... If it was gnarly, I would say it was gnarly, but it was... Dude, it was like we crashed at zero. I should have cleaned him out, and I would have won the race. But like,
but
I actually was too nice. Like, I literally—that's
nice,
my opinion.
And you were nice, and then Bubba
like,
should have
drove off the berm.
It was so slow. He should have just kind of look and then see you are coming, like, because people like blame me for not squaring off Wyndham.
But there was no chance.
There's no way in hell I could see or like square. But in this case, Bubba could have squared you off a bit because you went all the way to the exit.
I'm looking up the crash.
Give us your verdict, Red, when you see it. Okay. Reed, what's up? How are you?
Boys, how's it going?
What's up?
Chad Reed can do whatever he wants.
All right, fair enough.
greetings from Canada. Awesome to talk to you boys. Congrats on the 300.
Thank you.
Got a comment and just a quick question.
Sure.
A few years back, I was in Dallas when Reed was battling Villopoto and saw him go down. My heart sank. Like, when you flew over the bars like that, it was like you could have kicked me in the nuts, and that would have been better.
I'm sure Chad felt bad also.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I kicked in the nuts and everywhere else.
Just being a Reed fan and being there and seeing you battle for it was pretty cool. So on to the next one. I got thinking for like Monday to Friday what you guys do or did. How many when you're training and stuff, how many friggin' close calls do you guys have when you're just trying to stay in that safe zone of riding over your head or, you know, riding safe just to get to Saturday?
What about that?
I mean, it's a good question.
Even the current days, current guys, like, I'm sure you guys are in touch with them.
Yeah, I mean, it's a constant battle that we all have, you know, like, you try to manage it the best you can, but you're the whole idea of practicing isn't just to practice at 80%. I mean, you're trying to find, you know, a half tenth here, half tenth there, you know, to get fitter, stronger, faster. So, but then with saying that, I don't remember having a whole lot. I mean, yeah, I've had a few crashes here and there, but it seems like for the most part, it's much more like clockwork than the races, you know, like everything, like Villemin said, it's like everything's a little bit more controlled, track conditions maybe are more, you know, more favorable. And that's why they have to be a little bit more favorable, because you can't, you know, you got to somewhat be safe during the week.
Sure. Thanks, Reed. Appreciate it, man.
Cool. Thanks, yeah, you bet. Have a good one, boys.
Thanks. Appreciate it. Let's get into some training questions. What's up, Tyler? How are you? What's going on? What's your question?
Hey, yeah, sorry. Thanks for having me on. I got two quick questions
for
you. One for the three of you. So we know how eating is and, you know, nutrition and stuff like that nowadays is chicken and rice. But back in the day, it was Camels and Bud Light. What have you guys seen from, you know, the 90s to now training-wise? Were people working as hard back then as they are now? You know, food, what's changed?
Timmy?
I think everybody's a little more a regimen, like, you know, a little more scheduled than they were back in the day.
Ricky really ruined it. Is that true, as everybody says?
I mean, yeah.
No, I think MC did.
Yeah,
I think indirectly MC did, because he was more like on skills.
Uh-huh.
And then, but before MC, I think they were training hard, though.
O'Mara,
RJ, Anna, O'Mara, Ward. Those are big, like, they were doing stuff. There was naughty stuff.
Even Wardy, like, to this day, like,
yeah,
I go, well, I mean, he's currently riding across country right now.
As we speak.
You know, as we speak. But yeah, like, I go, you know, mountain biking with him and stuff, and, you know, he trains Sealy, and it's like, dude, you know, like, Sealy's never going to be that gnarly, you know? Like, it's just, if that was a gnarly era. But I do think that Ricky sucked the fun out of it for sure.
I think it's MC that kind of, you know, started the new era where he was all about skills because he was better than everybody else. And then, so he pretty much killed the competition that way, you know?
Yeah.
But, and then the other guy thought they could beat MC being better rider, but they couldn't be. He was the best. It's like trying to beat Ricky as his own game, being like a gnarly dude.
Right.
You cannot beat him. You have to beat Ricky by being a better rider, let's say.
Yeah, like I think Chad beat him on technical skills.
And that's what I had to do.
Right. Yes.
Yeah.
And then,
would have beat him at Pontiac.
He figured out how to beat MC. You know, I beat MC a few times. Why? In the last few laps, too, because I grinded.
Yeah.
Because that was his weakness. But maybe too many guys wanted to be more skilled than MC. It was not possible.
Right.
It's like you want to be more skilled than Stephen Curry, a three-pointer, if you can't beat him by shooting three-pointer. You have to beat him by doing something else.
Right.
And I think that's kind of like, you know, those two eras, you know. But I think in the 80s, they were super gnarly. They were doing maybe more stuff than people they
Wardy's,
do now.
Wardy's got a story that he rode 85 days in a row. He would sneak in a ride of dirt bike before he flew out on Fridays. He would ride on Sundays.
I thought I heard the same story. I thought it was like 100 and something days.
Okay, the Red Dog's probably heard him, but like, what about the Barnett stories?
Barnett stories are crazy.
You know, like, but just a graveyard of Suzuki's at his house because they would just literally ride those things to the ground, you know? So I think that in some aspect, and that's why those guys didn't last long. I mean, 24, 26
they
years
were done.
Old.
Stanton,
they're
done,
you know? And I think that you're starting to see that craze again, but I think it's more that they've earned a lot of money and then they just kind of over it, you know, like
I think the volume of work was maybe bigger in the 80s.
Yeah, and I believe that.
And also they made good money, but life was cheap.
Yeah,
you know, like I think the price of living went super up.
Are you saying Alden Baker's expensive for these guys?
No, I think it's
a few guys making money. Alden, one of them.
So yeah, I think a lot. You know, but $100,000 in the 80s was big money compared to maybe $1 million now.
Yeah, Bradshaw signed a 3-year, $1 million deal, so 333 a year, and it was the biggest. It blew everybody out of the water. You know what I mean? People couldn't believe it. $333,000 was just.
Yeah, but you know how much stuff you could buy with that much money in early 90s?
Yeah.
Compared to 2017?
Yeah. I don't know.
Even houses and all this shit, you know?
I think, too, with the social media, and there's always, I remember when Racer X films come out, I thought it was the coolest thing ever to get on Racer X films. Mm-hmm. But now it's like everybody can post everything they're doing. And I think there's a lot of fluff in it too right now.
There's a lot of fluff. I mean, I think that, you know, I think that certain trainers are really smart in allowing certain things to get out. And I think that that's the craze that you see. You only see the craze going in that direction because, and I think that that's smartly put out there.
When you see RV,
they show the naughty stuff. Or
I believe that they pick and choose what they allow to be seen, and they're smart at what they show. And I think that's let out sport, and you see it from where we live.
Yeah.
But you know, like there's a trend. There's a trend of what people are doing, and I don't believe that the people and trainers that are good are doing what you're.
What they're showing or what you think they should do.
Yeah.
Well, I remember, Timmy, you were talking, and you were a little older then, but you were talking to Wei about training, and you were telling him, as I got older, I did less off the bike. I rode my dirt bike. I rode my motos.
Yeah, I mean, it. The bottom line is you got to be good at riding the dirt bike.
Yeah.
That's a priority. We kind of seen the phase of, you know, where everybody's into cycling, and then everybody's into mountain biking.
Yeah.
And then everybody's into the gym. Like, there's always these, like, cycles.
I'm with Red Dog.
Seems like the craze is,
you pay to race. You're a racer. You're a dirt bike racer. And then, you know, you should ride your dirt bike. You know, it doesn't matter.
I don't really follow other sports, but I don't think any other sports are really doing a lot of dirt bike riding, or Steph Curry's not riding a bicycle,
right.
He's like shooting threes all day.
He's shooting threes all day. Right. So,
but it's true about McGrath, though, I think, and it's true about Ricky. I think what you said is perfect, DV. McGrath had everybody covered on skills, and you could see that back in the day when you watched those old riders. He would stick his landings. He would make the insides. He'd stay lower than everybody. It was ridiculous.
I think there was two from what I seen.
Except for Summercross.
Well, McGrath had a track in his parents' backyard. When I was growing up, Ezra Lusk had a track. His dad was always building him stuff. He was always super good at Supercross.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have a track. And then Ricky kind of caught on, and then Ricky got his own place. Like, so they kind of started a little bit of a trend there, too, where, you know, if you're in California, at one time, McGrath or the test tracks were the only tracks to ride, really.
Yep. Yep.
You know, so he's out riding in his backyard.
Yep. And he's jumping from lane to lane.
Skills.
Yeah. And then Ricky's like, hey, I can't beat this guy on skills, so I'm gonna wear him down. You know, I'm gonna beat him down and get in better shape
But the opposite works too.
Yeah, yeah.
Like Chad beat Ricky skills.
Right.
Wyndham beat him in skills, and Washugo, you know, did that.
Yeah,
that was skills.
Yep.
It wasn't you know. So that's why you cannot beat the best guy.
That's why we need you to team up with Chad, Apollo.
He's gonna
and
die.
Rocky. We'll skip the dying part.
Give us a couple days, we'll kill each other.
And we'll get into some of those stories.
I live close by. I can come over too.
We're going to take our first commercial break of the night here on the Pulpmx Show, presented by BTOsports.com and Fly Racing. 300 marks. We did it. We made it.
Yes, we did.
So we'll be right back after this commercial. Chad's already taking their headsets off. So I guess we'll just go to commercial. All right, everybody. See you after this commercial break.
I ride for JGRMX Suzuki, and you're listening to The Pulp Show, and Steve Mathis is an idiot.
All of us have one thing in common. When it comes to leaning that bike into a corner, floating a dirt bike through the air, or blasting a sand berm in a UTV. And that is passion. At BTO Sports, our foundation is built around family, which allows us to offer unparalleled customer service. Knowing we share a common interest, we look forward to the weekend as much as you. So we offer 3-day express on orders over $85. BTOsports.com is proud to be a premier source for motorsports parts and apparel for well over a decade. Due to our reputation for excellent customer service and great prices, from motocross to mountain bikes, sports bikes to UTVs, BTOsports.com has what you need, because our passion reflects yours.
Yeah, that's right, people. That's Van Halen. I want to tell you about my two favorite things in life, Van Halen and Fly Racing. FlyRacing.com, they make much more than just moto gear, mountain bike gear, snowmobile gear, hard parts. They've got it. FlyRacing.com. The F2 carbon helmet, it's as close to a factory bike as a helmet can get. It's out of the box and onto the racetrack ready helmet for guys like Millsaps, Baggett, Kennard, and Pike. Carbon fiber, Kevlar, Coolmax, MIPS. Fly Racing's F2 carbon has 10 different graphic styles, 22 colorways. Go to your local dealer, get them from flyracing.com. Please check them out. A whole line of hard parts as well. Flyracing.com. So tell me, why can't this be love?
Do you ride a stock bike? Then why drive a stock truck? Enfab offers innovative products to take your truck or Jeep to the next level. Innovative high-quality styles will let you customize your vehicle just like you customize your bike. The new RKR rails with patented detachable steps provide ease of entrance around town and clearance and protection for an off-highway adventure. Enfab's direct bolt-on MRDS pre-runner bumper with multi-mount and LED helps light up your world. Justin Barcia, Weston Pike, and Filthy Phil are all Enfab users and fans. Visit Enfab.com to learn about all of the innovative products and outfit your build. Enfab. Get your truck in gear.
Attention, KTM riders. Need a little orange bling for your KTM? Maybe some cool new KTM power wear? Or just a few parts to freshen up your ride? Whatever you're looking for, KTM Parts Express is your place to shop. KTM Parts Express, the number one online source for all your KTM needs. With over 40 years' experience in the motorcycle industry, customer service is our specialty. Our warehouse is packed full of the latest KTM powerwear clothing, powerwear accessories, and genuine KTM replacement parts. Huge inventory, great prices, fast, accurate shipping. Use the code PULPMX to save 15% off your order. KTM Parts Express, the number one online source for all your KTM needs.
Everybody knows Racetech is the number one place to go for your suspension. Everybody knows that if you go Pulpmx 17, you get a discount at racetech.com. But besides that, did you know Racetech? They are now the home of engines. Racetech suspension and engines, great guys. They've done a lot of great work for a lot of privateers and different riders in the pits with their motor work. Precision engine services are dyno, flow bench, and then track tested to provide maximum performance and reliability. The Racetech engine services use the industry's most desired state-of-the-art equipment and a championship-proven experienced team. They're really pushing their engines, and they're really doing a good job down there, those people. What Think about how many years they've been doing incredible suspension. Well, they've added engine work to their program with guys that have been around the sport for a long time. Pulpmx 17 gets you a discount on their engine services, whatever it is. Rebuilds, performance, they can do it. Got four-stroke motor problems? Racetech.com, everybody. Check them out.
Guts Racing, the leaders of seat technology, has tons of new stuff for 2017. Guts Racing has new products like RCH Factory Suzuki Graphic Kits and complete Husqvarna seats. Guts Racing has added new gripper material colors, fluorescent yellow and pink, to go with nine other colors we already have. Guts Racing even expanded to more teams and riders. 2017 Guts Racing will be seen on JGR MX, RCH Suzuki, Factory Husqvarna, Cycle Trader Yamaha, Blue Buffalo, Barn Pros, MCR Honda, Pro Circuit Kawasaki, Malcolm Stewart, and many, many more top teams and riders. Guts Racing has the world covered for 2017 and beyond. So now it's time you join the Guts Racing team by using discount code PULPMX2017 for 30% off at GutsRacing.com.
Randy Richardson from Michelin here, and I'd like to thank the Pulpmx Show listeners for your support and share some information about Michelin motorcycle tires. Michelin offers motorcycle tires for everything from cruisers to sport touring, sport bikes, and adventure touring motorcycles. And as we celebrate our 10-year anniversary of our iconic partnership with Harley-Davidson, you'll find Michelin Scorcher tires on an increasing number of factory-equipped Harley-Davidson motorcycles. New for 2017, Michelin introduces the new benchmark for sport bike tires, the Michelin Power RS, featuring many of Michelin's patented technologies, all of which contribute to the incomparable grip, handling, and flickability of the Michelin Power RS.
I just want to hear the motocross stuff.
Fair enough. Let's focus on the Michelin Starcross 5. Because the Pulpmx Show listeners are important to Michelin, we're going to continue to sponsor Steve's janky radio show.
That's right.
While I'm not like some people who say,
I know everything,
I do know a few things about motorcycle tires, and I'd like to share some of the key features and benefits of the Michelin Starcross 5 tires with you. And I promise it's not a bunch of corporate
blah, blah, blah.
The Michelin Starcross 5 tires are specifically designed for use in a broad range of conditions and terrain. They're available in sand, soft, medium, and hard versions, and are offered in 21 size and fitment applications.
Yeah, you like that?
In addition to the exceptional performance and durability, the redesigned architecture of the Michelin Starcross 5 features a bead profile that makes the tires easier to install. And everyone knows,
easier mounting, always a good feature.
If you're riding on Michelin Starcross 5 tires, but you have friends that are still buying other brands, please tell them,
No.
Encourage them to try a set of Michelin Starcross 5 tires. And if you haven't tried Michelin Starcross 5 tires yet,
you're out of your mind, dude.
Visit your local dealer or online retailer to purchase a set of Michelin Starcross 5 tires and install them on your bike. Who knows? They might just help you learn to do a backflip in a day. It worked for the Doom Goon. To learn more, visit MichelinMotorcycle.com and follow us on Instagram at Michelin Motorcycle.
Want a chain and sprocket kit but aren't sure what you need? Then call Vortex Racing at 800-440-3559 and get hooked up with a V3 performance kit. They have more gearing than your garage has room for. With over 30,000 possible gearing combinations, Vortex has the right gearing for any track condition. It's a ridiculous amount of gearing for nearly any bike. Join the ranks of Chad Reed and Cooper Webb on the factory Yamaha Supercross team and rock a Vortex sprocket. Available in red, black, blue, silver, and green. Yes, green. Call a doctor because things just got sick. Warning, may cause extraordinary power, excessive performance, and speed so fast your eyes will bleed. Call Vortex Racing at 800-440-3559. Mention promo code PULPMX16 to get 40% off next order. And don't forget to sign up for the Vortex Athlete Support Team for 2017. For more information, call 800-440-3559 or visit VortexRacing.com.
Attention riders, welcome to Atlas Air Flight 604 with non-stop service to a better neck brace. Please follow along as we outline the safety features of this revolutionary device. Located on the underside of the frame is a convenient, easy open system. To fasten, simply insert the release bar into the left frame. To release, push the release button and pull the frame apart. We suggest that you keep your neck brace fastened throughout the duration of the moto, as you may experience an unexpected huckabuck from time to time. To ensure a safe ride, please keep your neck underextended at all times. In the likely event of an over-the-bars emergency, your brace will double as a suspension system. Although the Atlas brace will not be noticeable, it will be there when you need it. If you are riding with a child or someone who requires assistance, secure your brace first and then assist the other person with a Prodigy, Tyke, or Broll. We ask you to keep your brace on until your moto is finished. Maximum surface area is located on your chest around the sternum, back around the spine, and up over your shoulders with extra padding over your collarbone. Should you need more, please request a Defender Roost Guard or Guardian Body Armor. We remind you that this is a non-rigid neck brace. Tampering with, disabling, or destroying the product is prohibited by the limited lifetime warranty. You will find this and all other safety information in the user manual located online at atlasbrace.com. At this time, we ask that you remain standing with throttles in the wide open position, elbows up and two fingers on the clutch. On behalf of the captain and entire crew, thank you for flying Atlas Air. Enjoy the ride.
WUSA is the number one source for quality wheel sets and wheel building services. They are the exclusive importer for Talon and Kite Hubs, along with DID and Excel rims. Their wheels and wheel building services are trusted by the finest teams in the country. Teams like Factory KTM, JGR Suzuki, Rocky Mountain MC KTM, Rockstar Husky Star Racing, Monster Energy Babbitts. They all trust of ya. No job is too big or too small. WUSA, everybody, we thank those guys for coming on board with us. Whatever you need for your wheels, hubs, wheel building services, they've got it. Mention Pulpmx when you call down there, and they'll give you a discount. They ship nationwide. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram at WUSA.com. WUSA, they are all things wheels. Do it. WUSA. Do it.
Gear Alloy Wheels. Since introduced in 2004, the Gear Alloy brand has dominated the truck, SUV, and Jeep market with a wide range of styles, sizes, and finishes. Featuring unique, aggressive off-road styles, along with fashion-forward SUV styling for today's discriminating sport truck and off-road vehicle enthusiasts alike. Designed and engineered in SoCal in order to stay on trend with design. And sourced worldwide to ensure the highest quality, best-looking product available. With styles available in 16-inch through 22-inch diameters and 5, 6, and 8 lug applications, including 10-inch and 12-inch wide options. Whether you drive a Ford, Chevy, GMC, Dodge, Ram, Toyota, Nissan, or Jeep, there is a Gear Alloy wheel style for you with 20 different wheel styles to choose from in black, machined, milled, and chrome-plated finishes. Gear Alloy is a proud sponsor of the NFAB and Pro Yamaha GNCC race team and has been a longtime supporter of seven-time WMX champion and X Games athlete Jessica Patterson. Be sure to check out all the Gear Alloy wheels at GearAlloy.com or ATDWheels.com. Get your trucking gear.
Starting now, you can use the code PULPMX17 to save on Gear Alloy at SoCalSuperTrucks.com.
Gear Alloy wheels for your Jeep, truck, or SUV. Get your trucking gear.
Established in Northern California in 1989, Works Connection's original idea to bring top-shelf motocross and supercross products to market still holds true today. Offering protection and performance upgrades in the form of either aluminum or plastic skid plates, the patented ProLaunch Start device, radiator-saving radiator braces, or the unique tack hour meter with maintenance timer, being just a few of the product choices Works Connection stocks. Tested and trusted by RCH Racing, JGR Suzuki, Star Racing, Rock River Yamaha, and Babbitt's Kawasaki, you can count on Works Connection. reliable products that deliver. Available on the web at worksconnection.com or your local retailer.
Founded in 1999, PivotWorks was created with the vision of providing a fast, easy, and complete solution to maintaining the suspension and chassis of your dirt bike or ATV. By taking all of the hard-to-find parts within the different chassis and suspension segments and packaging them into one easy-to-order kit, PivotWorks helps simplify the way you buy dirt bike parts. You can save time and money by ordering a PivotWorks swing arm or linkage rebuild kit that contains all of the necessary parts for a complete rebuild. Whether it's wheel bearings or a complete shock rebuild kit, PivotWorks has what you need to get your bike or ATV handling like new for a fraction of the price of the OEM parts. If you race, ride for fun, or just like restoring bikes like Mathis, PivotWorks should be your first choice when it comes to bearing and seal replacement. After almost 20 years in business, PivotWorks is still the leader in OEM quality aftermarket bearing and seal kits. And PivotWorks is giving back to Pulpmx listeners by offering a special 30% discount for all orders placed online. Go to PivotWorks.com today and use the discount code PulpShow2017 for a 30% discount on your order. Ride hard, ride fast, ride PivotWorks.
EK Chain set out to design a chain that was as elegant and beautiful as it was strong. The result is the 3D chain by EK. The first thing you'll notice about the 3D chain is its formed outer side plates. They have a curved form that helps to reduce weight. The centers of the plates have a recessed rectangular stamping that adds an eye-popping appeal. The inner side plates feature lightning holes and rounded edges to further reduce mass and put more power to the pavement. 3D chains by EK are available in three colors: chrome nickel, black gold, full gold. 3D's elegance is matched only by its strength. 11,400 pounds of tensile strength, to be exact. That's enough to handle any motorcycle, no matter the terrain. The QX2 X-rings that are featured in the 3D chain have a better wear resistance than standard QX rings by 30%. This more efficient design results in a chain that transfers 1% more power and torque to the rear wheel. EK is accepting applications for rider support. Get your 3D chain by EK at a great price through the EK Rider Shop. To apply, visit ekchainusa.com and click on Rider Support.
Pulpmx show presented by BTOsports.com Fly Racing. Negotiations are going hard here in the studio. All right, we're back on, guys.
We're back.
Are you guys done talking, or?
Kind of.
Are we negotiating?
I mean, we're in a talk show, aren't we?
And that'd be so much better if people could have heard the pre-show thing and then the break conversation.
Well, apparently right now the iPhones are more important than the show, everybody.
I'm working.
Pulpmx show 300, everybody.
We need a better noise than that.
That's a perfect pulp noise.
That pretty much goes with pulp.
Right, exactly.
Right there.
Oh, man. Tony Lessie's on the line right now. He wants to talk about MX Sports. Oh, wait.
Oh, yeah. I want to talk to Tony.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
No. Please don't.
I couldn't. I screwed everything up.
Yes, you did.
Come
on, put Tony on.
Hold on.
I'm about 50%
inside of MX Sports.
All right, everybody, BTOsports.com, Fly Racing, NFAB Jeep and Truck Parts, Racetech Suspension and Engines, Vortex Racing, Gear Alloy, Roost MX, Pivot Works, X-Brand Goggles, Michelin Starcross 5, Works Connection, FMF, Atlas Neck Brace, W Wheels. W has been behind your effort for a while, Chad. Whether it was Team 2-2 or now, yeah. EK Chains.
Project 04.
Oh, W helping you out?
Yeah.
A little bit of that? You are more into this project bike than I think I've seen you in anything else. You love it.
I think it's pretty really emotional about it.
He's... I can't wait to ride it.
Okay, wait. You have a 2016 YZ250 that you're hoping to put a race motor in and ride that, like, moto down on that.
No.
Oh.
Well.
And then you're going to build, like, this project is going to be just...
So both project bikes are getting built at the same time.
Okay.
And, I'm at a bit of a standstill on parts. My 04 bike is hopefully going to be, like, the legit bike. And then I'm hoping
but
my...
But not going to ride that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I want to ride it.
All right.
So it's like I'm going to ride it, and then eventually I want to put it away.
Right.
But I do want to ride it because I want to see what it's like. I want to ride it back-to-back with the...
16?
Yeah. And I've got a few things that I'm going to tweak on the 16 that's hopefully going to make it as good as the 04.
I thought I saw your championship bike at a museum somewhere.
Oh, there's... Yeah, you just stir me up right now.
See?
I've got a sweet...
I know, if I got a bike in a museum, I'm sure you got
Chad is bitter about this. He doesn't have his championship bike.
You know, nowadays, your contract, you get the bike.
He's won how many races for Yamaha? I don't even know. Probably.
I guess not enough. Not enough.
Yeah, clearly not enough.
Hey, I've seen Ricky has them in his living room, huh?
Yeah, all the ones in his house.
Above his pool table.
That's actually pretty cool.
Yeah. I mean, Timmy's got one from Full Factory. No motor internals, or is it?
The whole bike.
Is it internals, too?
Donington Park bike, yeah.
Yeah, from the Disney Nations. Kawasaki. Here you go, Red.
Is that what that is, Donington? I thought it was a Butts Creek one.
No. They're pretty much the same bike.
Pretty much
the
same bike.
708 was
right.
The same.
Did you guys win over there? You won over there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you won it twice?
I lost with Steve.
fourth best mechanic of all time that he's ever had. Welcome back, everybody. Michelin Starcross 5. They're introducing the Michelin Starcross 5 a little while ago, pushing the boundaries of off-road performance for riders of all levels. Four versions, hard, medium, soft, and sand. DV knows Michelins, stands by Michelins.
I ran Michelin's in 01.
Did you? At the DeGroote?
I was second in the world championship.
MichelinMotorcycle.com, wherever Michelin motorcycle tires can be sold. We thank those guys from Michelin. Been killing it for us. Also, David Villeman's appearance on the show brought to you by Pivot Works. If it works, it pivots. Pivots, it works. Premier aftermarket solution for rebuilding your wheels, forks, linkage, swing arm, shock, and steering stem.
Seriously?
I use Pivot Works to build all my project bikes.
I kind of talked crap about them the other day. I'm sorry.
Grab a Pivot Works kit, do it right, and save time and money.
That's
lifetime
so funny.
Replacement warranty.
Because that's so funny you said that.
All right, okay, let's go. Let's move on. What were you talking
about? I missed it.
Nah, because
the mute button.
Because, no, it's not. It's funny. It's funny that you said that I'm brought by Pivot Works, because they had this commercial on TV that was kind of like weird.
Pivot Works did?
Yeah, okay. And then during the Nationals, before NBC Gold, that commercial was every time there was a break, it was this commercial, and I OD'd on it. I was like, I can see that thing again. There's this one guy I don't even know riding Impala. It was like not very well done or whatever, and I talked about it like last weekend. That's funny.
Boy. Well, Pivot Works is bringing you DV on this show, and also I use Pivot Works to rebuild all my project bikes. I got an 89 CR downstairs.
Great company.
You're going to love it.
Good company.
You actually raced it. You raced an 89.
You're going to have to bring it into the AC for him to go and see it. Yeah.
89? 90.
90, you were Honda?
I raced Loretta's on a 1990 125.
But Honda?
Honda.
Yeah, okay. All right, I'm off.
UFO?
Fox.
Also, Fly Racing, Timmy, you were Fly Racing's first ever paid athlete.
Mm-hmm. Helmet.
With the helmets.
I know.
And look at them now.
I know. I remember.
Killing it.
All their guys have life contracts. You got one?
I don't.
Dude.
There's like this Yamaha bike.
Right?
It's like the equivalent. Gotta call Craig and ask for
a bike. I got your replica somewhere. I don't know.
I do remember when Fred approached me, my agent at the time.
Yeah, right there.
He said, I got this company Fly wants you wear their helmets. And I was just like, Okay, tell them to send me one.
Yeah.
It's actually good.
Yeah. We are giving away a Fly F2 carbon helmet with MIPS, the one that Blake Baggett wears, Weston Pike, Trey Kennard. Trey Kennard, Timmy, we should see him at Red Bud, you think?
Yeah, Red Bud.
Red Bud? Man, tough year for him. Jeez. Really feel for him, huh? Like, he left Honda after so many years and trying to get used to the KTM, and it's been, well, you can relate a little bit, where you're just always coming back from an injury.
Yeah, not always. But
no, but.
Yeah, he's had a little rough year. I guess the last one was really silly, going around a lapper at Paula, passing somebody, just fell over and
yeah,
broke his collarbone.
Right, yeah.
But Red Bud, I think is the plan to come back.
That's the plan. Let's give away the F2 carbon helmet to the fifth caller. Mark's fifth caller calls in 702-586-7857, gets the Fly Racing MIPS F2 carbon helmet. Thanks, everybody, for calling. Chad Reed, David Villeman, Tim Ferry in studio here on the Pulpmx Show, and we thank everybody for listening, and it's been a good show so far. Are you guys having fun? Is it okay? DV?
Good.
How's the phone, DV?
Yep.
Good. Good. I'm checking Twitter.
He's trying to get his money back from last night.
Great. Kyle, what's going on? You got a question for these guys?
I do. The previous caller before the break, he had a good segue to my question.
Okay.
Obviously, with training, there's training, diet, and the science of both of those seem like they've converged together. And so my question has to do with, do these guys, if not sure of who, feel like that there's going to be a dominant rider to come out, another McGrath, Carmichael, Villopoto, somebody just everybody because they have all their crap together, but in this day and age without performance enhancers and anything that, they're regulated, so all these advantages
kinda
that were cutting edge, are we at a point where somebody's going to just take it to a whole next level, or is it
it's a good question, especially with Roczen? We don't know. Like, I mean, Roczen may never race again, right? I mean,
I don't believe that, but yeah,
I think he comes back, but
yeah,
I'm saying, like,
at what level? Who knows?
Who knows?
When?
And ET hasn't grabbed.
I'm kind of with DV. It goes back to skills.
I don't think that there's a current group of people out there that I didn't see that. And no one in the pro ranks is going to do that. I don't believe so.
Thank God, I say. Too many years of this guy and James and Ricky and MC, Donji and Villopoto.
They were the good years. Trust
me. I got friends.
All three of you. If that number four guy wasn't around,
that's all I got is seconds. Come on.
Nah, you have a bunch of supercrosses.
Yeah, but without the four, I may be the great.
Dude. I had Jeff Ward, Rick Johnson, Jean-Michel Bale, McGrath, these guys.
And I don't know if, I don't know if it's like.
I think we're going through a weird phase. Like,
yeah.
You know, like the whole training system. Is just like when you go to the grocery store, you know, like that's all these big phases and fabs of gluten-free, dairy-free, no meat, meat, dairy, you know, like it's just, I think that we're just kind of going up, down, sideways, like no one really has a good grasp of what's going on. I think it's all trial and error and you got to figure it out, you know, so.
Thanks for the call, Kyle. Appreciate it.
Real quick. Still there?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Just thinking, to me, in my mind, because I feel like the science of it's coming around. There's been a lot of trial and error, lots of error with it, with Epstein-Barr and everything. It would almost seem at this point it's psychology behind the riders because everybody's pretty much on the same playing field. The equipment's good. The training's excellent with personal practice tracks, everything you guys mentioned before the break. I would think the mental side's probably – the next hoop to jump through for if there's somebody who can dominate.
That goes back to as far as motorcycle racing in there, mentally strong guys. I'm always amazed they're multimillionaires in this sport. You look at them from the outside and these guys appear to have everything you could ever want. And yet sometimes some of them just aren't mentally strong enough for whatever. They don't have confidence or whatever. And it always amazes me because from the outside, you look at these guys and you're like, oh man, they got it all figured out. But they don't. So I think that goes back to the earliest days of racing.
Well, I think if easy is
yeah, if it was easy,
thinks it is, right. Then everyone would be doing it. But there's a few names throw around the list, and I think that the bikes get less talked about these days. You know, I think it used to be about how gnarly you were, 80% bike, you know, rider and 20% bike or whatever. But as a current rider and a racer, the bikes play so much more of a role than it's given credit now. I mean, we have so many things to work with and things like that. And I just, my personal opinion is the bikes don't get talked about enough.
All right, thanks, Kyle. Appreciate it. We have our winner, everybody, for the Fly F2 Carbon Helmet. Thanks to the folks at flyracing.com. We got our winner. Kyle, what's going on? What's your question for these three? Kyle, you there?
Oh, yes, me, this Kyle.
Yeah, what's your question?
Hey, I got a couple questions. I got a question from the group, and then, Steve, I got a question. I'd like to test your Tim Ferry knowledge.
Oh, I go. So,
you want me to start off with the Tim Ferry knowledge?
Yeah, bring it.
Okay, I've got a it's in a shadow box. It's an old jersey. It's a number 22, Tim Ferry. What year and who was he riding for?
Well, I think he was 22 twice. He was 22 in 1998, and he was 22 in 1996,
97.
So he was 22 twice.
Depends on the color.
But JT, right? 97?
Yeah, it was a 96? Yellow Thor jersey.
Thor is 96, then 97. Sorry, 97. When he, all I remember from 97 is number one, Kyle, when he won the title.
Ah, good and, stuff. Well, you are sharp.
Yeah. Anyways, what else? What's your question?
Fantastic. So my question for the group is, if there's one thing that anyone would change about the sport, be it nets in the corners, road to Manitoba before you get to Supercross, whatever it may be, what would you change about the sport today?
Let's go. There's a lot of – it can go into it. DV, what would you change?
A lot of things.
All right.
Do three things. Top three.
First thing – salary cap in 250 class. I think that's important. So to make the 250 guy go up, we see even this year, I don't think outdoors, I don't think the 450 class is that deep as everything it is, with a bunch of riders out retiring, not racing anymore, doing supercross only. And I think you need to, I actually talked about it in one of my columns. You can't have 250 guys making over $1 million. Or
no, 250 guys making over $1 million.
There are, if they win championship.
No way.
You don't think Cooper Webb made over $1 million last year?
No.
Yes, he did.
Well, you mean combined race wins,
bonuses and everything? Yes.
Maybe.
Yes, he did.
I don't think they're making as much as you think.
Yeah. So he made $500,000. He won two championships last year. Right there, he's at $1 million. Salary, race bonus, championship bonus, over $1 million.
Yeah, it's pretty close.
These guys that make $500,000.
That's like trifecta, though.
I call it that, too.
How do you think? How many Martin's making salary?
I wouldn't know.
I think it's
around $500,000.
I think it's like 400.
Yeah, around $500,000
for all his gear. You know, get
yeah, and
gear,
then that, you won a few races, a championship, over $1 million. Why do you? Because then you don't want to go up.
Yeah,
you know?
I think,
know, I think we need to put a salary cap in 250, so those guys can be 450 guys. Those guys should be 450 riders already. Two-time national champ, he should be a 450 rider. Shouldn't, you know? 250 is a stepping stone. It's not like a career class. But the way it's structured, they stay, because if they don't point out, then they change that rule again this year. They don't point out, they're going to stay because the money is too good. They can't make that kind of money because they will not make top three. If you don't make, you know, if you don't do podiums in the 450 class, you know what it is, you don't make that much money, right? You cannot live with a failed purse or AMA purse. So that's why we need to, you know, and the money the factory save in 250 class, put it more in the 450 to make it the real premier class. I think there's too much importance on 250 class right now.
I agree. Thanks, Kyle. Thanks for your call. Appreciate it. Thanks,
Thank
man.
Thank you.
That has been the Truck Hero question of the day. What would DV change? Truck-hero.com. Supplier of premium vehicle accessories made in the USA to outfit light trucks and SUVs from bumper to bumper. NFAB Bedrock Husky Liners. The Truck Hero Guys sponsor the JGR team. JGR Suzuki, 2018 RMZ coming out soon. I think a couple
I'm
weeks.
I'm so excited about this.
Seems like it. Do you want me to try to get you one? It's an all-new bike, DV.
Yeah, so excited.
All right, everybody. Tim Ferry, Chad Reed, David Villeman in studio here. Let's go down memory lane a little bit. So, Timmy, you're at Yamaha with DV for a couple of years. DV, you come off an 0-2 season when you led the points for half the year, got injured, finished second.
What was your first year, 0-2?
0-1.
0-1?
Timmy won. Timmy won.
2000.
2000 on the factory team?
Yeah.
2000, I rode with Chaparral.
Yeah.
With Jeremy.
Who was 2000 team? You and Button.
Yeah, that's it. Yep. So and, after the second race or third race, you. That was only
They didn't
me.
Replace him?
No. They were talking to replace him. They asked me about, they were thinking about, I think you maybe tried his bike.
Nope.
You didn't?
Nope.
Didn't Fro, I mean, Fro tried it, right, and crashed. Isn't that what he got hurt on?
No. He crashed on his own. But they wanted to call Fro and Timmy to replace Button, and then they ended up doing nothing.
Yeah,
I remember already, that because
they never
Keith,
talked to me.
Because Keith actually asked me that. He said, "Oh, who would you put on Jimmy's bike, Ferry or Hammig?" That was weird.
And you said not Ferry.
You probably didn't know who I was.
No.
No, but you know, obviously, I said Timmy. Obviously, because you know, Fro was at the end, right? He got hurt in '99 or something, and then that was pretty much it for him.
So. At the end of 0-2, this guy over here wins the championship at Yamaha Troy.
Yeah.
What do you remember about him coming over? And he had started living at your house a little bit, Ellie and him in the motorhome, right? At Timmy's place?
No, house.
With us,
oh,
yeah.
Okay. Okay.
So he came over in 0-2, well, end of 0-1,
yep.
Yeah. Beginning of 0-2. And I didn't even know who he was.
No. You're not a follower of the
no,
GPs.
I have no idea. And then they said who he was, and then I, you know, something.
You still don't know.
I still don't know. He rode a Cali. I know that.
Right.
And then... He won a Supercross, and then he came back east at some point. I can't remember. Beginning
outdoors.
Of the, after the first couple of Nationals,
yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah, he won the Supercross title, won every race but one on the East Coast on
yep.
The Yamaha Tri bike.
An iPhone, right? Was it?
Were you
yeah,
Were you always going to Yamaha factory team, or did anybody else? Like?
No, I mean, yeah, I had other offers and stuff like that, but I signed my Yamaha contract, like, I want to say around Daytona.
Like, he saw you win the first few Supercross and was like, okay.
Yeah, like, I already had, like, by Daytona, I had my clothing yeah. and my
right.
my bike deal already done.
I remember you did some West Coast 250 Supercrosses,
yeah.
not 125s, 250s.
Yeah, and I got a couple
and you
fourths.
Were, yeah, you were pretty good because I was working for Way.
Yeah.
And I'm like, look at this guy. Like, he's, like, really good. Like, you know.
What year was that?
02.
02.
O2.
On the West
you got six or something, A1, something like that?
Yeah, fifth or sixth, yeah.
So you kind of took him under your wing a little bit.
I got caught
a little
up
bit,
in,
yeah.
yeah.
Like, you were working
Carmichael.
With Jeff Spencer?
Yep.
And then
the Rocker Crash.
Took him in?
Yep. Yeah, he stayed with us in the summer, and I think it rained all summer, man.
Yeah.
It's
brutal.
Like right now.
Yeah.
Were you ever thinking, like, this guy's going to be what he turned – I mean, he's one of the greats. Were you
– No, I mean, honestly, like
– What were you thinking?
And even when I watched the – You know, I know he won the Supercross Championship that year, but
yeah.
it wasn't like I was, like, paying attention to the series.
Right.
Like, I was so
yes.
focused on what I was doing that I wasn't looking around that much. So, I mean, in reality, kind of caught me by surprise a little bit, for sure.
Right.
I don't think anybody expected him to come from Europe, win the championship, and
no.
then go next year, win 250 stuff. So,
I mean,
yeah, it was quick.
Guys just don't come over, even
Not
from
usually.
Australia, and adapt to Supercross that good.
Jeff Leesk.
Jeff Leesk. I was thinking the same thing. Jeff Leesk.
Which you raced against, probably.
No, I didn't, actually. But I remember him as a kid,
right.
and it was a big deal. I believe he rode a
Yamaha Honda.
Both.
Yeah. He rode
yeah.
both.
Back to Yamaha here, I think.
And then Honda.
On a terrible bike. You rode one time Nationals on a
terrible
bike.
Yeah, I remember that they sent you down to 426, and you were...
Yeah.
Sure, if not a 426.
What, out for Supercross or outdoors?
No,
outdoors.
For outdoors. Like, we were breaking our light spikes all the time, so then they sent out a...
Oh, really?
Yeah, okay. sent out a 450 to practice on.
So you had no... You knew he was coming on the team in 03, but you did not think he was going to beat you or...
I mean, I didn't really look that far into it.
Yeah.
I really wasn't.
DV, what
about
you?
About
did
it.
You see this
Either
guy
way.
And was like, yeah, he's going to win 50 Supercrosses and...
What's weird is... I don't think don't know if it was the bike that he was riding in 250. I don't think that was it was that good. But, and then on the other coast, you had Bubba, which was insanely impressive. You know, that was his rookie year, right? And that was your rookie year on the mm-hmm. East. And then if you compare the two, he said Chai wasn't there. And then he wasn't jumping as much stuff. And I thought maybe the bike had something to do with it. And what was the most impressive is the switch between 250 four-stroke mm-hmm. and 250 two-stroke. Yeah. Everybody, you know, struggled. From Ricky to a bunch of people, only like yeah. a few, you can only count a few guys. Even Harvey had a tough time, you know. And a lot of people had a tough time jumping. And the way he improved from, you know, 02 Supercross to 03 in that winter, that was insane. Because I don't think he wasn't jumping like great stuff. He was good in the whoops, but he wasn't like super impressive like a Bubba. But then when he jumped on the 252 shock, then he became somebody that would jump a quad, jump something insane right away. And that's why I think he was limited with that 250 four-stroke Yamaha, right. I think. And then when he jumped on the great bike, that was the 03 Yamaha, the 252 stroke, then that was like a different rider. And then he caught everybody by surprise, I think. And then at the plastic track, practice
did you win A1? Did you win A1 03?
Yeah.
So the first race. Yeah.
He got in the tunnel with Ricky crash and everything, right? Was that race?
I hole shot it, and well, actually, Mike Brown hole shot it, but I was second, and then within the second turn, I was leading. So I led in the whole race.
The whole
but yeah, Ricky, I think, got a bad start, crashed. Yeah.
Was the one that kind of under the tunnel?
That under the tunnel was when, in 02, when Larocco and him got into it. Like, Ricky went over the bars. Larocco ran into him going into the whoops.
I'm not,
you won that race, I think.
Yeah, but I don't think that was it. I don't think that was, no.
That's 02, I think.
But
yeah, that was 02 when Ricky
crashed.
Yeah,
that's 02, but I think 03, one of the Anaheims.
Oh, before the tunnel, and it was a step-up double, and then you went under the tunnel. Remember when Roncada kept cleaning him out
a
couple times? But anyway.
Yeah, that was...
I mean, were you pissed, Evie, a little bit at him? Because you were like, you were top guy on the team.
I wasn't really top guy. I was the only guy. Really, the top guy at that point was MC. I always been MC. Because even if I was beating MC in 02, and then, Jimmy had a bad year.
Yeah,
arm pump.
Was bad,
it was arm pump gate kind of type of deal. And then I was never really the top guy. You know, maybe the guy, I was the top guy in 01 maybe, because I was maybe the best one in the team because I won Supercrosses before. But when Chai came in, I was fine with it because it was good for us to improve and to see at the track. We were kind of pushing each other. And, you know, obviously, it's always tough to see somebody come in and be that good. But you have to deal with it and then just get to work.
We used to be like, why is he revving his bike in the air so much? Like, what's he doing?
He would rev it all the time.
Right? You're like, what's he doing?
And why he doesn't warm up his bike and just go for the triple right away?
Yeah. You know, what if I worked on his caliper?
No.
But yeah, he did. Yeah, he definitely, the curve was quick.
Yeah. Like, and, I remember thinking like, okay, this guy's a 250 Supercross champion. He's going to do well. He's fast.
Yeah.
But it's like,
but
wait.
Seriously, if you want to, you know, try to understand what I'm trying to explain, watch the last couple races of Supercross, the East Coast, or whatever, Vegas 02, and then watch Anaheim 03. You'll see what I'm trying to say.
Yeah,
you know, the difference is like, it's a different guy.
But I also think if you step back, and now I hear Chad, because he was at my house a lot, he tells stories, he was riding 252 strokes in Australia before he ever even went to Europe. Then he spent a year racing in Europe on it. Like, so there, so
he knew
we
the
didn't
bike.
Know.
Yeah, he knew the bike, but
and, I took, that. And that was what I took heat from. Like, a lot of people, like the media, the fans,
sandbagging,
like
or whatever.
No, it was more that, like, I think I made a lot of comments like, because I didn't like the bike. I hated that 250F, you know, and I didn't really want to be in that class.
Yeah.
And it wasn't the class that I hated so much. It was the little, like, I never rode. So that was my first time. Like, well, I was already a two-time Supercross champ in Australia.
Yeah.
Second in a world championship in Europe the year before in Motocross championship. Yeah. You know, and
no
so,
one wanted to hire you so for
like,
250 class.
Yeah, like I had already spent 3.5 years on a 252 stroke.
Right.
And then for the first time in my actual pro career, I had to step down to the lights class. And I just, it didn't, I didn't like the bike. I didn't like how it was. You know, it bogged all the time, you know, these things.
Was it like Dak trying to get your, like, was Dak calling people? And
Dak
saying,
was trying, Steve Butler, I think, pretty much.
And like nobody, everyone was like, forget it. This kid's got to ride.
And then, so like when I was in Europe in 01, De Groot actually wanted me to drop down because I was doing good in the lights class. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the 250 class. He wanted me to drop down to the lights class the next year and win a world championship. I'm like, well, I feel like I could do that if I stay in the 250 class, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, okay, Pichon's winning now, but I feel like my second year I'd be better.
Right.
And I said, I'll sign with you, but I want to guarantee that I go on to the Cowie U.S. team.
Okay.
And Cowie wouldn't do it. And, you know, it's funny. I have conversation about it with Mitch nowadays, and Mitch is pissed off at the world because Cowie wouldn't let him, like, Cowie, you know, Mitch is pretty open to poaching people from over there
and
obviously wanted to keep me in the Cowie family. And
as
it worked out, you know, Yamaha Troy was pretty much the only team that ever called me. Bob Moore was the one that called me. And
I mean,
even though it wasn't the class that I wanted to ride, I just wanted to go to the U.S.
Yeah. You've always had, like, a lot of confidence in your abilities, and that's what makes you who you are. Did you really think you could beat Ricky in 03? Are you like, I can win? Like,
I never watched Ricky and thought that there was anything that I couldn't do, you know? Like, I mean, not to sound like but, like, I honestly never watched him and was like, oh, my gosh, he's gnarly. Like, I mean, sitting in the stands, like, he was quite sloppy, actually, you know? Like, made just in the whoops, he was really loose and out of control and
so
things like that. So there was things that I felt like I could, you know, be competitive and, you know, sure, I thought I could maybe win, but, you know, it's no guarantee.
Yeah, it was
maybe Ricky was the easiest, like, to beat when he was on the Honda, though, in Supercross.
Yeah, for sure.
Because I think his bike was...
I think enough beatdowns by Chad made him look at his bike setup and be like, what am I doing?
Yeah, I think even in 02, his bike...
Like, we used to watch video in the lounge and be like, look at this guy. He can't even get through the... Like,
he was going through the boost. Missing the boost in second.
He was almost dying.
We were going
dying.
In fourth.
Yeah, right.
He was going through the boost in second. Yeah. We were going in fourth. I'm like,
I think by the end it was just going side to side, and then he finally would get out of them, you know. Yeah. But then his desire, of course, is just.
I mean, you know, like when you think about bike setups, I mean, pretty impressive what he was able to achieve.
Yeah,
really, you know.
For sure.
I mean, because 02 when I raced him, and then 03 when you raced him, more like his bike was.
You know, in 04, like obviously he missed Supercross, but you know he was racing. He was going to race four stroke. You know, like he was switching to the four stroke, so that would have been an interesting year.
Yep.
You know, if we're going back, it would be I would have loved to have raced Ricky on a 04 bike in 05. I think that would have been a fun.
Oh, yeah, the aluminum frame, you mean bike.
Yeah.
Which all three of you never liked.
I hated it. I remember the back-to-back test that we did.
Yeah.
And I was just I remember going like, dude, you know, typically we've all worked with Japanese before and everything's same but different, same.
Right.
No, it's not the same.
No. They swore to us that it was like, they're like, hey,
it's the same. I remember.
This is exactly the torsion, the flex.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same.
God,
same but different.
And then all three of you guys were like, no, no.
I think I was a good second slower on it. You know, it was a struggle and I think the
whoops were like,
the
whoops was terrible.
God, whoops and flat turns, and then it happened to be that 05 was like the first generation, like that time when they started taking berms down.
Yeah, when Gerke flew
so
in the
like,
stands.
You just felt like, you know, what was once your strength was suddenly, you know, like somebody was taking it and throwing it back down your throat.
Right, right. Speaking of Ricky Carmichael, on the line now, Chad Watts. What's up, Chad? How are you?
Good, how you doing?
Good, thanks for calling. Chad Watts, Ricky's old mechanic, everybody. Watts Perfection.
In those years.
Yeah.
I know a few of you guys.
Just a few of us, huh? How are you, buddy?
Just a few, yeah. Vuillemin, Reed, yeah. I know a few of you.
Mm-hmm. What's happening, man?
Just getting
bikes ready for this between customer stuff for public, and getting all the two-strokes ready for the Cody Gregg / Chris Gregg Memorial Race.
Yeah, this weekend at Muddy Creek, right? Yeah.
Yep. Bringing out three CR250s, YZ250, and a YZ125.
Cool. Hey, you want to call us back? We got some bad feedback on your end. Give us a call back, Chad.
Yeah, I'll call you back on myself.
Thank you. We'll ask him about what Ricky kind of had to say about you. And Timmy, this whole time, I'm your mechanic. We got carbs falling off. We got backfiring.
Yeah, I think my
and
my
Ricky wants to kill you.
And what?
And Ricky wants to kill
you. Ricky wants to kill me.
Because I was going to take him out for Chad.
The funny thing is that there was complete nothing there.
Not one word ever said about anything.
As a matter of fact, you guys were a little.
You were pretty aggressive, though. You were pretty aggressive with Ricky.
No, because I mean,
I think in Salt Lake you went.
No, I cleaned his ass out.
Yeah.
I meant to.
I know you did.
I did it.
Timmy and I were like, I mean, we weren't hating each other, but we were kind of like battling with each other a little bit away from that. So that, like, it was the complete opposite. But like Ricky cross jumped him so gnarly.
He did.
And it just, like, I'm just like, that's not cool, you know? And then to the, like, two turns later, I cleaned his ass out.
I actually moved over and let them both go by. Yeah.
And then you had a...
I got a hole shot.
I know.
Yeah, and well, I was in the stands because I got hurt in Daytona and I race Supercross. So, you know, I grabbed popcorn and I watched the race. I was like, this is going to be good.
And then I, at some point in 03, did you go on a two-stroke? For a couple of races.
We lost it. With Timmy,
I think if we go back to it, I think honestly, what it boiled down to is any frustration that I had with Chad, honestly, probably came back to my bike.
Right. Yeah. And this guy's on a two stroke and
he comes
ass.
In and he's, and, he, and I never heard of him. In like a year, he's went into supercrosses.
Correct me. And then I believe I had the option, like my contract, I had the option to, like they. They wanted me because I was obviously four stroke
they
on a 250.
You four stroke badly.
They badly. I mean, we all remember. Like I want to say, like all the way up until the week before U.S. Open, I was four stroke.
Yeah.
And we were going racing four stroke, and I'm like, dude, I don't like this bike. Like, remember, I think it was new that year in 04. It was a new bike, maybe.
No, 03 was new.
Okay, so 03 was new.
03 was new.
And then, anyway, I remember being at the test track, and I remember the track actually. There was like this, like a. Like a table, and it went up, and I was like, I tripled up on, and I went to go off, and it bogged, and I just went, that's it, I'm done.
That was Timmy's day.
You know, like I'm just like, that's it, I'm done. And then I, you know, I had like literally a week to prep for on a two stroke, and then I think that just that wore on Timmy, you know, like.
Well,
and,
I kept.
And I see why.
I kept crashing, and then they made me wear blue gear. But they gave him two options. They only gave me one.
Right.
So it was just
a
bunch of.
Hey, you had Jeff Spencer as a trainer.
Yeah, we had
Chad.
Yeah.
Everything.
And I agree. Spencer starts wearing a 22 hat.
Yeah, that was it.
And you're going.
That was the breaking point.
You're like, wait, my checks are also going to you, and
the
I got
same
your
amount.
Point. Your point. Like, you're like, wait a minute here. Like, you know, Chad's killing it for sure. Yeah.
What happened to Spencer?
I mean.
He's still around.
He's still around.
Like,
but
around motocross?
No, not motocross.
I think he went pretty quiet after the whole Armstrong stuff. He got deposed.
Yeah,
he was a part of the whole deposed.
But they finally gave me the option to ride the 250, and then I got hurt.
Yeah. Chad, you're back. Chad Watts is back. Hey, Chad. In 03, Chad Reed here is beating Ricky. What was Ricky saying behind the scenes? Was he frustrated? Like, were you guys testing? We talked about his bike setup hurting him a little bit. Were you guys trying to get him to change?
Well, there was no changing when it came to Ricky. It was automatically going to hook a buck to the hoop. He wanted to land in the corner and make one turn instead of two or three, depending on what terrain, so to speak. And I only worked for him up till Anaheim round two or three.
Mm-hmm.
And we won that race. And then that's when I went in-house for four-stroke development. So as far as his setup, after that point,
I had nothing to do with.
Right.
But in 02, when I built the bike and went to Anaheim 1 and the handlebars were laid back by the rear fender and the grips were down by the foot peg, you know, that was his setup because the head cube on the Cowie set higher than, opposite than a Honda. So mm-hmm. he had to roll back the bars to be comfortable because he ran actually McGrath bend bars. If I'm not mistaken, that year McGrath ran RC bars.
Yeah. Remember that?
Yeah. Oh, that's funny. Yeah, it was. I remember watching. He was great in the corners, but
which is like when you think about his bike setup. It's
yeah,
the
of course.
Like
right.
No, I mean I wouldn't say that was a my. I wouldn't
yeah,
say
because
that's
the
my
front
choice.
End was yeah the low the back end was low.
Yeah.
But the bars being that low, the center of gravity
yeah,
really
was
low,
low,
so his bike looked really small and choppered out. So, yeah.
And then what year did he buy the Bridgestone? He showed up with a Bridgestone for a
02.
Race.
02. That was 02 against
okay.
me.
Oh, yeah.
We had that thing removed real quick.
Minneapolis.
Yeah. Oh, did Yamaha have something to do with
it? Oh, we, yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I wasn't even on the team at that point.
Okay.
But I remember the shit talking for sure.
Yeah, that was 02.
It okay. was a wheel that it was a LaRocca wheel laying around, I believe, right, Chad?
No, actually.
No, that was a better story.
110% truth is I had my friend Mike. Go by
Mike LaRocca.
No, his nickname is Windshield because I met him.
Oh,
like
I know Windshields.
Yeah.
Windshields.
Yeah, Windshields.
I know Windshields. Yeah, Windshields is cool.
Yeah,
Nebraska. Right?
Yeah, because me and him, me and MacGyver gave him the nickname because we were at the USGP and he showed up with these glasses. And they were bigger than his head.
Yeah.
So that's how he came up with Windshield. Anyway, I gave money out of my wallet and asked him to go to Doug at Bridgestone and buy a tire. So he did.
So it was a production tire?
Production tire.
Huh.
And took and mounted it inside the Honda rig. Tried to get rid of it as much as I could. Of course, put the Dunlop stickers on it.
Right.
But as soon as you got to the gate, and, you know, the Japanese tire engineers are taking photos, they saw it, and then that's when it all blew out of proportion right there. But that was a production Bridgestone tire that year.
Which were still badass.
Still good, right, yeah.
Still, yeah.
And I don't know if I got my damn money back. Anyway. We won the race, so I made enough, so I'm not too worried about it.
Yeah.
On the Bridgestone?
Yeah.
I heard it was Kia that went to a dealership and bought a couple or something. I heard that story.
Yeah.
So
the best story, I think this is after Chad. I want to say it was 03, maybe end of 03, but he might have been there. But I was, we would always, the test tracks are all close there in Corona. I would go over and ride up to, you know, look at Yamaha.
Yeah.
I mean, look at Suzuki and Honda, and it would always piss the Honda guys off. So you knew it. So you'd do it more, you know. And then Ricky's out there.
You two guys, you and Ferry and Reed, you guys would always, in the day, we could hear you guys testing on top of the hill, and then we could see your blue Yamaha sitting at top of the hill when we were done testing.
Yeah. We'd go check it out.
There.
And then so you'd ride up there and check it out. Dude, and then I want to say it was Shane Drew puts the sprinkles on me.
Yeah.
And I'm watching Ricky. I'm like, dude, that bike looks pretty good.
Uh-huh.
And I look at it. It's a Yamaha. And they have red plastics on a Yamaha. And then they had the blue frame with all silver duct tape.
Oh.
And then I had a mole on the team back then. Nate Dogg.
Oh, yeah.
So then Nate Dogg, I'm like, we're neighbors.
Yeah.
And I get back and I'm like, Nate Dogg, what were you guys riding today? And he's like, I can't talk about it. I can't talk about it. I'm like, come on, man, talk about it. And he's like, I can't talk about it.
Really, huh? Chad,
I wasn't there.
Oh, you don't remember this?
I wasn't there.
He's playing in the fifth.
Now I can say the truth about everything. I was not there, so that's after I started watch Perfections.
It was funny, though, talking about Chad. You talked about working for Four Strokes for Honda. Yamaha developed a Four Stroke. Doug Henry, Timmy, you were on it, doing well. Button, of course. And Honda came out with their bike when, 04? 03?
03,
I think. No, 02, actually.
No, Yeah, it's Rhino.
Okay.
Yeah, because yeah. Ramsey raced it in 02, and then 01.
But that was a factory
had,
one, wasn't it?
No. Okay. Rhino rode the factory one in 01.
Okay. So I remember Steve Butler, R&D Yamaha. We wheeled one into the race shop. So this would have been 03. We wheeled an 03 CRF 02. In. Or 02, whatever.
Yeah.
We wheeled it in, and we're like, we're fucked.
Yeah.
Like, the thing carburetes perfectly. Yeah. It's narrow. It's lighter. It's everything. Our bike's this tank. Steel. Yeah. And we're like, we're fucked. We're just screwed. We, like, literally tried to, like, move weight around. We're thinking of, we remember went to 3-speed. We lost the counterbalancer. We tried all this stuff. But I remember looking at the Honda going, and it ran perfectly. Like, all the test guys were riding it and never hiccuped everything. And we're like, oh, these guys. Like, there was a much better bike. The 4-stroke was so good.
Well, I just think that's kind of the process, you know. Yeah. It always evolves like that.
I mean, you
and
were,
I actually think that, you know, I think that their aluminum frames were so on the stiff side in the 2-stroke eras.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think that when they stuck all that power and torque into it, that particular bike, I think, was really well matched. Like, it was the first, I think it was the first aluminum chassis bike combination that was, like, really, really good. And I think
that's when you got to know the AMA rules. You have the rules, but you have that little gray area. And I know, Chad, you know what I'm talking about. And you do too.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You have that little gray area you can work with.
There was nobody who had more different frames than Honda.
No.
They had a lot of frames.
I've always rode stock frames at Honda.
I was on the edge of the gray.
Mine was
That's
stock.
By all means. But I was within rules, six. But it almost was black. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. No, awesome. Oh, hey, Chad, thanks for calling, man. Appreciate it. Thanks
good
for the
good to hear from you, man.
Trip down memory lane.
As well.
All right. Any of you boys going to be at Muddy Creek this weekend?
Nope.
No. TV.
I'm thinking I'm going.
Do you know where Tri-City is?
Hey, David, I can get you a 2-stroke to ride if you want one.
Hey, I want one to ride. Yeah, give me 04.
You know, those guys, you know, especially Chad, he's on his project 2-stroke thing.
DV will be on a rooftop LA bar.
No, I'll be with my kids next weekend, so probably on a basketball court somewhere.
Oh, Chad, you need to send me that motor and let me give you some watch perfection love.
Ooh, I got a stock one sitting there. Maybe I'll box it up for you.
No, that'll be
see
good.
If you can,
see
if you can beat
the
Mitch's.
Main thing. What's that?
See if you can beat Mitch's.
I'm Chad. I'm confident. But the main reason why I called in is for this Greg family, because the father and son were going to a GNCC race. It's been about 10, 12 weeks ago, and unfortunately something happened to their Freightliner hauler, and they went off a ravine, like at a bridge, so to speak. And it caught fire, and Chris and Cody did not survive, of course. So the main reason is, you know, if people can promote, that'd be great to help the family out.
Awesome. Yeah, well said. Good dude. I met him once. He rode a 252 stroke at Bud's a few years ago and got like 15th or something.
Oh,
and
wow.
Like, it did really well. So it was a really sad for sure. Thanks for calling, Chad. Appreciate it. And thanks for promoting it.
Thank you. Hey, Reed, send me that motor.
All right, bud.
All right. See you, man.
Y'all have a good one. Y'all take care. And thank you very much for the time.
Thanks, Chad. Appreciate it. Chad Watts, everybody. Gear Alloy, the sponsorship of the Rocky Mountain ATV MC WPS team of Blake Baggett and Benny Bloss and Millsaps. And is Millsaps ever going to race outdoors? What's he doing? Millsaps.
I think he's
he's training. Alex Ray? He's training Alex Ray right now.
Is he really?
Yeah. He's a trainer. Anyways, Gear Alloy, please check out if the best wheels in town, gearalloy.com. Get your truck in gear, whether you drive a Ford, Chevy, GMC, Dodge, Ram, Toyota, Nissan. Gear Alloy wheel style for you, over 20 different styles. Pulpmx 17 at socalsupertrucks.com. Saves you money at Gear Alloy. This is the Gear Alloy semi-cold call. Jimmy Perry. Let's call old JP, manager.
We were talking about a comp edge when I tell him to go around the track. Remember that?
Did he won the bet, though?
No, he lost.
No, he won.
No, I thought he won.
No, he won.
He won
I
the
said,
bet.
No parade lap, I said. And he took one.
We'll call him right now. Jimmy Perry, Gear Alloy, cold call.
I thought he won,
no
too.
No parade lap, I said.
I need to pee.
Yeah. Yeah.
Me too, actually. Can we go together? Lean people. Holding it.
It's called the Gear Alloy Cold Call.
Hello.
Jimmy Perry. It's Mathis.
How's it going?
JP.com, baby.
That's David Villeman.
Hi, guys.
Chad Reed's in the bathroom, but Timmy Ferry's here also. So,
what's up, Jimmy?
How's it going, guys?
We are going down memory lane a little bit. We have to clarify something, though, Jimmy. When we were at Comp Edge testing, we bet you that you had to be within 30 seconds.
No, it was under 3 minutes.
Under 3 minutes, yeah.
Yeah, okay. That was under three minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, now you won the bet, correct, Jimmy?
No.
That is correct.
No, yeah, you think so. But the bet was no parade lap. You took a parade lap.
Oh, no.
I said no parade lap, and I give you $500. And then you took a parade lap. Yes, you beat the bet on the second lap, but that wasn't the point.
No.
I always pay my bet. I don't have debts.
No, but
I'll pay up when I have to.
Jimmy did not collect the money. He said put it towards charity, I remember, or something. But, Jimmy, you had a helmet and boots and gloves, right?
No boots. He had his Doc Martin type deal. Yep. Always wore those things. Those things were
still
I
does.
Think I had Jimmy's helmet, his goggles, and maybe DV's glove in my work shirt.
And you did it under 3 minutes around Comp Edge.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Told you, DV.
On the second lap.
It's what I remember.
On the second lap.
DV, we got a controversy.
He's stuck on the second lap.
Yeah.
I know. Hey, Jimmy, when we talk about the Yamaha days, 03, 04, 05, which one of these three guys gave you the most shaking of your head?
Easy money.
Which guy?
Yeah.
Oh, this is
probably Chad.
Shocking. What a shocker. That was the most shocking answer ever.
Who gave you the most results?
Well, that's true.
Chad.
Oh, yeah. I could have, you know, he wasn't there when I was good.
I know that.
He showed up in 03. He wasn't there before that.
Jimmy, I would have done better if you would have given me a better bike.
Okay, so Jimmy, Timmy needed a better bike. You screwed him out of that. And then you weren't there when DV was good, and that was also your fault, apparently.
Yeah.
Right?
I guess it's all my fault, right?
It's always your fault, Jimmy.
Don't worry, he's still the same.
You know how it works.
How did you manage these guys, Jimmy? Did you look? You came from Pro Circuit. You guys won, you know, tons of races and titles there. And Peyton, of course, you know, knows racing inside and out. When you got to Yamaha, you were new in 03 also. Steve Butler was the manager in 02. What did you kind of like? How did you approach it? What did you do? What was your mindset?
Well, I think every day was different, and those guys all had different personalities, as did the crew. You know, you were not an easy guy to deal with.
Oh, please.
In your day.
Dave Dye was harder than me. Come on.
Sounds good.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe.
But you gotta kind of respect JP in some ways, where he was at PC, where they tell the riders just, you know, shut up and ride, really. Mm-hmm. And then you come, you know, because everybody every kid wants to be a PC rider, and then they get there and they listen and whatever they say. And then Jimmy comes to Factory Yamaha, where there's me, Supercross winner, there's, you know, Red Dog,
outdoor winner,
and then the big
Red
hot
Dog was the Supercross champion in the lights class.
Yes, beating Ricky Carmichael, by the way.
And then there's the big next thing, first year, you know, Chad. Yeah. So coming from, you know, kids, you just tell them to shut up and ride, and then guys that win Supercrosses and in front, it had to be a huge transition, you know. And I think
I thought we had fun. Well, I don't know if we were young, and I was young and dumb, but like, I don't want to.
Yeah, you were.
But like, you know, like, I had more fun back then. I remember going to Europe when we all went to Europe and working out of the crates and Gothic, you know, like, I felt like. Yeah, I don't want to say too much because of my current situation, but
it
was fun.
It was a different time for sure.
Yeah, like I felt like we had a good time.
It's almost like a 14 years later. Jeez, that's more than I thought. But,
well,
it's a little more serious now, huh, Jimmy? Like, things are real serious now.
I think it's a much different time than it once was, and it was then for sure. You know, I think that there was a little bit more fun at times, but, you know, times have changed, and you got to keep moving forward.
Going to Europe, though, we went to Arnhem and Geneva.
Yeah.
To start the year.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool. Yeah. Feld,
we were the first ones to do it.
Yeah, did Feld just say, hey, Yamaha, bring your guys? Like, Jimmy, no. What was behind that going?
I got paid guys?
You did?
Yeah. I got paid in first class tickets.
Oh, nice.
So, yeah.
That was a fun bus ride, though.
It was. The train and...
I remember being on the bus and everybody was asleep and we were all in the back just
all I remember is Dave Dye pushing, I want to say, Gothic on the trolley, on the cart, on the, like, you know, like an airport cart thing. Yeah. And just, like, spinning him and whatever. And taking a nap in the crate.
I was like, I'm not spending a week with you guys.
Yeah, thanks.
I'm like, I'm out. I'm going to my house in France. I'll see you in Holland, guys. So I went to ride.
You didn't invite us to your house, though.
Yeah. I actually rode. I went home and rode.
My, I worked for Nick Way in 02 and a top privateer, by the way. And then I joined the team Yamaha and I didn't know DV. And the first race was Geneva and Craig Monty. Do you remember Jimmy? Craig Monty didn't tell DV what spot he was in the heat or something. And we got back and you started yelling at Monty. And I'm like, is this going to be this all year long? This guy just yelling at his mechanic. Like, you didn't tell me where I was.
You cut the story short.
Okay.
The story is, I crashed on a stone, and back in the day it was this e-race, semis, and everything. And then I crashed on the start, and then I thought I was far behind, but I guess I came back. I was fifth, not too far from fourth. But
there
was
only four factory guys there.
Yeah, but there's like the fourth.
It's not that big of a deal.
And there was only one in that race.
The fourth.
Yeah, exactly.
The fourth guy. The fourth guy was not too far. And then Monty doesn't tell me what position I'm in. And I'm like, dude, I'm not going to kill myself. I have to go to the semi anyway. So, you know, I just finish and I go to semi and then go transfer. And then I finished the race and Monty said, oh, you got fifth. I'm like, what? You never told. Just tell me where I'm at so I can go and transfer right away. I don't want to go to semi.
I'm yelling at Monty and I'm like, oh my God, this is.
Hey, who won that race?
You did, DV.
Okay. Thank you.
But Chad was coming.
I got taken out.
Tortelli and you hit
him.
I was in front.
Yeah. I was in front. We never know.
Got us a podium.
We'll never know.
I don't even remember.
Your podium, I think Langston.
We got second.
Langston got third, right? That race?
Timmy doesn't remember anything, Jimmy.
Langston was third?
I think Langston on the KTM was third.
I think Tortelli was third.
Yeah, I want to say. What did I end up?
Anyways, you won Arnhem the next week.
Yeah, you killed us there.
Back to where you're kind of starting on. Mm-hmm. In general, even with MC there, there was four guys that were at the practice track that were fast. So it was daily. You know, everybody was really trying to
one-up
each other.
Remember Yogi in 04? It was Mach 1, but he was a year old.
He was on our bike.
Yeah.
He was on our basically one-year-old bike, and four of you guys.
He was almost unbeatable on the practice track.
No. I remember the track was nasty, muddy.
Yes. Remember
the track was muddy, and I'm watching him, and he's almost dying on every jump. And I'm like, I'm not going out there. And then Jimmy's like, let's go.
Let's ride.
And I'm like,
that's his line.
I'm not ready.
Jimmy made you mad, and then you started roosting David Bailey. He was on his quad. I remember that. Because he was there helping you.
Yeah.
And then Jimmy was laughing, and I was kind of chuckling, too, because it was pretty funny.
So, Jimmy, in a roundabout way, you got Bailey roosted. Good job.
No, I don't think I had anything to do with that.
Oh, you had everything to do with everything.
Hey, Jimmy, what about the watering of the track between DV and Chad?
No, the watering is...
I was not there.
No.
Me neither.
Nobody was there. Nobody was there.
It's just me.
Because that was his in Chad cool days. Cool guy. You know? You know, at one point, he came in, he was, you know, almost homeless. And then he became like the cool guy very quick. Cool guy hanging out with Ensign and being bros, you know? And then Ensign was there that day.
I was going to say, I think it was me and Hansen.
Yeah, no shit.
I think Hansen did it, and I just got the blame.
Yeah. No, but that
I
was.
I don't think so.
Yeah, that was. I don't know what you guys were thinking. Seriously, I was just to make me. Didn't.
Yeah.
No, I mean, seriously, what would you say? What would?
I would be pretty pissed.
You go, you train, and then you start doing moto. You're like 5, 6, 7 laps in, and then those idiots turn the fucking sprinklers on when you ride. So you ride, you keep going. Say, oh, you know, they're idiots. It's okay. I'll keep going. They don't shut them off. Like, at one point, it's like, okay. And then I get so mad.
And did you have tear-offs?
In Corona, no tear-offs.
I actually, you were doing your two-lap sprints on, like, you're like two on, two off, you know, like doing like you always did. And
I thought it was one.
And well, okay,
nah, but
maybe it was one.
That was
one.
A motor right now. That was a motor. I think I was with Bailey that day, and I was, you know, Bailey made me ride more than I ever did, actually. So it was going for a long moto.
My memory, I thought
your
dad
made you ride more than you ever.
Yeah, but that wasn't in the picture anymore.
Before Bailey, the one guy, the French guy, I believe.
Jackie.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember him. I actually think he was the one there at that point.
You think so?
Yeah, I think.
No, I think it was 03, around 03. Do you think it was 02?
I think it was that. What's that jersey?
It was definitely
03. 03.
Really? Yeah, it was 03.
But 03.
No, I think it was.
Chad wasn't homeless at that point.
Yeah. So, no, that was 03. Jackie was not there. I was with Bailey in 03.
And speaking of these guys, Jimmy, at one point, Timmy and Chad are not getting along, and we're testing at Ferry's house. And remember our bikes?
I never got that $20 either.
Remember,
you guys owe me a lot of money.
Chad, remember we had a slight problem with our bikes jumping into gear, and Chad revved the shit out of his bike inside Timmy's garage, and the thing jumped into gear. And Timmy's floor,
brand new. It was like brand new badass shop
epoxy.
Jimmy, yeah. Do you remember that? Yeah. And you were like,
Oh boy. How could you forget that?
And Gothic was just like, it's okay. It's okay. It's fine. Everything's gonna be fine.
Gothic's trying to like be the peacekeeper. And then Jimmy, I never ride at Chad's again, right?
No, other way around.
Oh, was that it?
Never come to Timmy's house.
That's it. Yeah. At some point, we were talking about these guys, you guys being enemies, and I'm like, they're done. Chad will never ride at Timmy Ferry's ever again. And I'm not kidding you. Like 2 years later, Jimmy, you're at Cowie now or whatever.
I don't remember.
And Chad's right. You post a photo. Hey, at Red Dogs. Jimmy's like, where's my money?
Never got it.
I think I did. I think I did.
I don't remember it ever being that bad.
Oh, he was pissed. He was pissed.
I was pissed in general.
Yeah.
I'm redheaded.
Yeah. The situation.
I wasn't mad about the garage floor, though.
It wasn't my fault.
But what was he doing revving his bike in a closed garage? We were all there with no earplugs.
No, it was like just on the outside. It wasn't like deep.
Deep in the garage.
Yeah, no, it wasn't. The mark's still there. I'll show you.
But Jimmy, it was a handful trying to manage these guys at times. I guess KTM, like, okay, Trey hasn't had a good year, but if Trey's on point. Trey, Dunge, Marv is as close as we're going to get to these three guys on Jimmy nowadays.
Yeah, probably so. You know, I don't think you're going to have big teams like you once did, you know, and that's probably the closest thing that you're going to have.
Is that just money, do you think, Jimmy? Is that just like budgets? Just they don't
money,
have any
talent, you know, guys being able to ride.
Mm-hmm. Because now, like, if you're Cowie, right? Okay, well, JG's been riding really well. But if you're Cowie or even Honda now, you know, they had Kenny, and Cole's great. But if you have an injury, which happens a lot, like, your whole efforts are kind of down the tubes. At least you had these three guys who, you know, swept the podium in Anaheim and were top five all the time. And I guess teams just, yeah, they don't have the budget anymore.
Cost a lot.
Yes,
the writers are overpaid, that's why.
That's funny, DV, you say that, because, you know, some people might say that about you late in your career.
And I believe I was overpaid. Or was I was? I believe it.
Guess some of it, you never paid me.
Yeah, I know. You lost
paid
the bet.
Over shit.
Lost yeah, the there's bet. You know, that's I think that's bottom line.
What else, Jimmy? What else stands out? Yeah, am I missing something?
We want to hear some stories.
What else am I missing?
Maybe the day that we were testing at Cahia Creek and it snowed.
Oh.
No, I wasn't there.
You weren't there?
No. Oh. Yeah, you guys were.
It was the week before. It was like the Thursday before Salt Lake City, and it starts snowing. And I'm just
and
like my
I
remember. I
want to
say, were you there, Red? I think you were there. Yeah. I'm sure you were there.
How did Chad take this, Jimmy? How did he take the snow?
He was not very happy. You know, I think that Timmy had his motorhome at that time, and he was there. And he goes, I'm just going to sit in the motorhome all day.
I thought you were there.
We're here. We got to ride. It's snowing.
I don't ride.
And my hands were so sore because
then,
they were locked up.
And I think the following race was Salt Lake, and it snowed there too.
Hey, so then the long story short is.
So then Jimmy took credit.
We're walking the track in Salt Lake City, and I'm like, we're never going to have these conditions. And then the very next weekend, it's snowing on track walk. And he's like, I told you, you're wet.
But I think, you know, I think the worst testing session, I think that was before Jimmy's time. That was in. Were you there in Honey Lake?
Nope.
Oh, when we went out at the.
You were while you
is that the one on the
that
side of the hill?
My time.
That was in 2002, and there was the one on the side of the hill, and it was freezing, and I think it rained the one day or something like that.
We were there like
that. Was 2002.
2 or 3 days.
Yeah. And right, then, that track would have been rad though if it had been.
It was like a crazy track.
Yeah.
And it rained for 3 days.
Yeah.
And we were there. We tested for 3 days in the rain called between Salt Lake and Vegas Supercross.
Is that what it is?
Great prep for Vegas Supercross. We were like ready for it.
Hey, the one thing about Jimmy that I remember was, and we would laugh about this Gothic and Dave and I, and Rookie too when Rookie came in. Jimmy, you were the king of like stopwatch. Like, these guys are out on
there
the track. Like, they're out, like, for the first 3 laps of the day. And Jimmy's click, click. Like, dude, they're just warming up. And you're like, oh, you never know. Never know.
Yeah, he's a little slower now.
He learned that at PC.
Right? The stopwatch, Jimmy.
You have computers
Jimmy.
Now.
Yeah.
Hey, now it's all about data. What does
data.
The data say?
What does the data say? Hey, Jimmy, did you or Keith ask me to take out Chad at Salt Lake? Or, Ricky. Carmichael at Salt Lake.
No.
Okay. All right. I just want to clear it up with another person.
I was in the truck too. So
you guys,
I know
you,
it was.
You guys hated each other at that point.
We weren't talking at that point.
I know.
I flew to the race. I hadn't even talked to him or seen him.
Right.
What would you help him?
Remember, hey, Jimmy. So at Bud's Creek 03, when Chad roosts Timmy in the face after the checkers.
Yeah.
And they run back to the truck. I wasn't there because we were on the far side of the track, and I'm not in the greatest shape. So it took me a little bit to get there. Yeah, yeah.
I think that was the only time that we really got it.
Yeah, we were. I was hot that
like,
day.
That was the only time we had words.
Jimmy, what did you? What was going on? What did you tell these two? Were you like, hey?
I don't remember getting to talking to or anything.
No?
Yeah,
no.
I don't think I said anything.
I think we sorted it out.
Yeah, I cool off usually.
I mean,
a few F-bombs.
I feel like I need a percentage of the win bonus that day.
Yeah, maybe.
I didn't get nothing. I only won the first moto.
Yeah, oh, what a glorious moto
you
that
see
was.
We've
1,500 AMA person.
What's that, Jimmy?
We've heard about the first moto win for years.
we're still hearing about it. Don't worry.
Yeah. Creek first moto. That was like one
yes.
of the lines.
Yeah. Well, and what's funny
and
is.
And then didn't the exhaust blow apart?
I actually fell. It was my fault.
He fell. It did not. The
fell on the first corner.
The first. The exhaust fell apart in the first moto.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah, but again, not my fault. But Jimmy and the GYTR guys, Jimmy, you were not happy with those guys down the road, down the hallway.
Boy, he bleeds PC.
That's why we. It's weird that we use Y Brothers the following
year.
Yeah, well, I was blowing out every moto.
Well, you lost a header, Chad, one moto.
Yeah, Millville.
Jimmy, and you were like pretty much had it. You probably don't want to say anything because GYTR Yamaha, but you were not happy.
You know,
hey, and also, too, talk about the first moto, Bud's Creek. Gothic went one crash with Short. Gothic also has a Bud's Creek First Moto.
Oh, no.
With Andrew Short. He has the same story. So it's pretty not far off. Jimmy Perry, everybody, on the Pulpmx show presented by BTOsports.com and Fly Racing. Factory Yamaha in studio. Ferry, Reed, Vuillemin. Jimmy Perry brought to you by Gear Alloy. Get your truck in gear. Pulpmx 17 is the code to save. Jimmy, we'll switch it to this weekend. Cooper Webb getting better, huh? You got to be happier with his results. Three motos. No, he's gone. He hung up.
Jimmy's gone.
Well, let's get
he
back.
Didn't want to talk about GYTR.
Probably not. He's so pissed.
Or he didn't want to talk about Cooper.
Let me get Jimmy back on the line.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, he just hung up. Gotta go.
Gotta go.
JT's coming up, too. Jason Thomas coming up on the show here.
On his birthday.
On his birthday.
Is he sober?
I don't know. Went out for dinner, he says.
You guys cut me off.
We tried. Unfortunately, we found your number.
DB reached over and hung up. He didn't want to hear it anymore.
Yeah.
But Jimmy, Cooper Webb better the last few motos, right? You got to be okay with
getting better.
Yeah.
Getting better.
Yeah, happier with his ride at High Point?
It was okay.
That's all we're going to get out of you, or what?
There you go.
Stopwatch it and...
Stopwatch?
Yeah, there.
No, they got the printouts now.
Oh, yeah.
They don't lie.
They never do.
And then what about getting Yogi on the team in 04, Jimmy? Remember how fast he was going? That was obviously a Mach 1 deal, but he was going good.
He was going Mach 1.
In practice. I actually thought, and I don't know if, but like, I thought entering into 04, like, I was like, shit, this guy's going to be hard to beat.
I know.
I agree, right? He was hauling ass.
And especially at the, you know, at the test track,
which is
where he was amazing. He went fast a lot of days.
And then I guess just he crashed a lot, right? Got hurt early, I think, early that year.
I think he did get hurt, yeah.
Yeah, something like that. And then also Jimmy Perry on the line here, Gear Alloy cold call. I really thought you'd say Vuillemin when I said who drove you nuttier, Jimmy. I really thought you said Vuillemin.
I was the easiest.
You couldn't take him serious.
I was easy.
Vuillemin?
Yeah.
Like when he ran down in his underwear
just
for the
whatever.
Sleeper picks?
Yeah.
That was
you just laugh at him.
That was fun.
Yeah, I think that DV was a little bit more high strung in his early days. By the time I got there, he was just kind of an easy going, just wanted to ride and do his own thing.
Yeah, like but you talk about something you didn't know because you weren't there. But I was the same then. I was the same guy before 03. I was never like, I was pretty easy. I just know what I wanted. I got it. Never really tested that much. Well, and hey, that was it.
Must be nice to get it. Jeez. I'm still
you got to know. You got to know what you want.
I'm still waiting for Jimmy to come up with that secret.
I went, you know, I knew kind of what
and,
I wanted.
And Jimmy, what about, we were laughing before the show because.
Really?
Yeah. Chad and Timmy's bikes were pretty close. The rake, the trail, the motor setup, the pipes, everything else, suspension, they were pretty close. And then there was off on the island was DV, huh?
That is true.
FMF pipe.
PC silencer.
Yep. He always
the silencer was,
yeah, really
was mandatory, huh?
Really soft suspension.
What?
PC silencer was mandatory.
Didn't he run Supercross and outdoor same setup?
Mandatory by the team?
Yeah.
That's Jimmy.
No?
No. I could have put a Bill's pipe, a Bill's silencer, and an FMF pipe.
How come you used always PC silencer?
Because they work better than the FMF. Huh? I picked something that's is every. I'm an FMF guy because
here he goes. He's gonna start.
Nah, I'm an FMF guy in a way because they help me and I know everybody there. But I'm not biased because obviously FMF wanted me to use a silencer too, but they never came up. They tried. Titanium, diameters, small, big holes inside, whatever it was, it did not work as good as the PC one. And I told them, I said, it's not good enough. I like the pipe better, obviously, but the PC silencer were better. So I just used that combo and it worked for me.
Jimmy, DV says that Bunkle Bob told him that he had the perfect setup for Supercross in his bike, motor-wise. What do you remember about that?
That was a long time ago.
I know.
You know, I don't know that I could honestly give you the right answer for that. That was a long time ago.
Do you remember the Gothic J Binghamton roosting DV's motorhome story?
No.
No, I didn't either.
No, no, you guys weren't. You were there, obviously. You were not on the other planet. Yeah.
Di grabbed me and said, hurry up, DV's going to beat the shit out of Gothic. Gothic was mad at DV's riding at Binghamton by accidentally roosted inside DV's motorhome. Mud and rocks and everything.
He was mad at me. I don't think Gothic was mad at me often. Like, maybe only once, maybe a few times that I remember.
Mm-hmm.
But Binghamton, he was like upset that you don't get that podium in second moto. I don't know.
He's bonus.
And then, yeah. No, but what about bonuses? We got to talk about those.
Mechanics bonuses?
Oh, yeah. With all year. Like.
Oh, you were so mad.
All summers, talk about bonuses. Bonuses, bonuses. At one point.
We did talk about bonuses a lot.
Yeah. At one point, I took Gothic G. I'm like, I'm going to give you a bonus. But if you shut up about it, at the end of the year, I'll see how much I made, and you know, I'll see what I can give you, and I'll sit down with my guy, and then I'll write
you a check.
I remember
you yelling, DV, I can go to France and find my buddy to do your job.
Grips and graphics.
Yes, grips and graphics, bro.
True story.
Grips and graphics.
Trust me, I've been working on bikes lately. It's not that hard.
Oh, here we go, Jimmy. Here we go, Jimmy. Now he can work on bikes, too.
He's been working on it for like 2 months.
Yeah. All right, Jimmy. Hey, thanks for joining us, man. Thanks for the walk down memory lane. It was a really cool time, and I'm happy to have these three in studio. And so far, it's been nothing but laughs.
Yeah, I can't believe they're all there, to be honest with
me
you.
Me neither. It actually wasn't that bad.
You know, Jimmy, we're easier than you think we are.
Yeah, that's what I think. See, Jimmy?
You know?
Mathis must be paying you guys a lot to fly you all out there, first class, put you up at a big hotel.
All of that, well, maybe not quite, but some of that. good luck at Muddy Creek this weekend, and thanks for coming on, man. Appreciate it.
All right, see you guys.
All right, thanks. Bye. Jimmy Perry, everybody, team manager of the year in
TMOY.
04? 03?
TMOY. I think it was 03.
03?
04. It had to be 04.
It might be.
Was it 04?
You won 04, so, and then we went 1, 2, 3.
I feel like
so
Feld maybe gave it to him because we all committed to Europe.
That's why I think it was 03.
Right.
It's probably 03.
Because we said we would go, like we were the only factory team there, right?
TMOY.
Let's talk about that.
What?
TMOY.
Like, remember that? Like, they were making this big deal. Feld was like, yeah, you guys are going to be the guys. You know, they sent us all there. And then I won world championship. And then when I won the world championship, they didn't even give me the number one plate until, like, the next weekend after Ricky had wrapped up. Like, we gave us the number one plate at the same time. And then the next year, Heath Voss does it. And then they blow up this, like, that's it. We're going world championship. You know, Ricky was going and everything like that. Yeah. It's a big deal. And Voss is world champion. They
but Voss was bigger than you then. You know, it was the people's champ.
It's just funny that like it's the one championship that's not talked
about.
Well,
I mean, or you know, Ricky and Stu raced all the rounds. Stu beat him in the world.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, "Yeah, no, Ricky wasn't trying." And I'm like, "But he was." Like, like there was this weird like you know thing where you were like,
"It was such a."
But then Daytona didn't count for the world rounds.
I think Daytona was the only one.
Right.
Which I think it's. Kind of silly that it's its own race. Even this year with this 20 laps versus 20 minutes.
It's a shit show. Yeah. Daytona is just garbage.
The track is horrendous. Oh. Like
track,
all
the
new
format.
Like if the rules and that are going to stay like that, I think that we need to like I love Daytona. It's one of my favorite races, but at the moment it's one of the worst races ever. It's terrible.
I mean, the track constrictions around the sprinklers and everything and they shortened
Yeah, but that's always been like
that. Yeah, they've been there.
No, but
just take a mid 90s layout and just do that.
They can't.
And like, well,
why?
Because the pit lane got widened 8 feet or something.
Yeah, that's true.
There's now you got to go around the sprinklers and
but
fit it into.
It's not the sprinklers it's necessarily the problem. It's the, you know, like this year we had to, you know, like they had flat track. So we had to work around flat track. It's like flat track, really?
I mean, you look at Daytona now, Ferry, and just be like, huh? Like it's not even like you remember.
God, I just remember
it used
doing.
To be
I
really
think,
rough.
Yeah, I remember it used to be gnarly.
Middle of the day.
You used to have to ride. You had to ride it so different. Yeah. And nowadays, it's just like another race.
Hey, everybody. Let's go talk a little bit about the Honda guys down at the Honda World Downey with a 5 freeway and a 605 freeway. Meet over 1,000 new Hondas in stock. Pulpmx gets you a free change from those folks. Over 100 used cars, including certified Hondas, and over 1,000 new Hondas in stock. They hooked me up with my Ridgeline, and I appreciate it. Honda World Downey. Let's get to our next guest. It's his birthday, everybody. Jason Thomas. What's up, JT?
What's happening?
It's your birthday.
It is. You guys got a little reunion going on there, or what?
We do. We're just trying to figure out at who it's and like when and everything else.
It's like a high school reunion, but with no chicks.
and JT, Timmy's actually getting some words in. Like, he's actually contributing. It's very shocking. Like, he's...
No, he's good. Nice. He's good. I like him.
He's good. Let me ask you, JT. So, you were racing these three guys at Factory Yamaha. At the end, yeah.
I was going to say.
you're in the main event.
It is his birthday. We'll be nice.
Yeah.
No, but let's talk about... So, did you think Chad would go on to what he did and what he's accomplished when you saw him in 2003?
You mean when he won the last six races of the year? Did I think he would do well?
No, no.
02. No, before.
End of
02
going into 03?
02, I mean, he wasn't crazy good those first few West Coast 250 races. It wasn't anything out of the ordinary for a lights guy, you know?
That was a tough fight.
Obviously, he was really good in the lights class or whatever it was called at the time. But, I mean, the guys he was racing, it was like Mike Brown and Jessamyn and... You never really know. I mean, look at Jessamyn. You know, he won and then he moved up and then was never able to do anything. So, I was unsure. I don't think anybody was rock solid sure before he moved up that he was going to, you know, turn into what he did. So I would be lying if I said I was, you know, absolutely certain. But I think the end of 2003, leaving 2003, you know, it was pretty clear what the deal was.
I just wish he would stop revving his bike so much at the test track because you'd be working on your bike, head down, working, and all of a sudden, and you're like, oh, my God, he's going over the bars. And then, oh, no, he's not. He's fine. He's just in
there. He's like Barsha.
Whoa. hey, and so.
I thought he was your friend.
It's not so much.
it was quite a difference in styles, too, between DV, Chad, and Timmy, huh? JT, when you watched him ride.
Yeah, I mean, you... If you just look at that one photo from the, you know, the whoops on the Yamaha PR photos, you can kind of see the different styles, you know. Just even in the whoops back then, I think the current style of riding was still evolving, and DV was, you know, way further back because he was so much taller, and I think Chad was much more in the middle, which I think McGrath kind of evolved that style of riding a little bit. And then Timmy was kind of a mix between the two, you know. But yeah, their styles were different. Even if you just listened to the RPMs on their bikes, they would all be a little bit different around the track. So different nights was each would seem to be a little bit better, but certainly on and off the track, they had their own style and personality, that's for sure.
Who got third in Geneva in 2003 at the World Rounds?
I think Langston did.
Yeah, I do too. Jimmy Perry
was
saying Tortello.
I said Langston too. I thought Langston was third.
That's a schlong shot.
Oh, that was a great drop. That was good.
It's Mark's over there in the corner.
Just look it up. Somebody can look it up.
I was going to say. I think it was Langston, yeah.
Hey, so did you look at the Reed Stewart pass in Atlanta?
Yeah.
And?
Chad had the inside. I mean,
are you playing like a Switzerland right now, like neutral?
No, I just think he had the inside, and I think he could have checked up.
We were debating this, JT, before last commercial.
But you're not
Which
finding
pass was it?
The Atlanta.
It wasn't
2011
like a T-bone.
Pass.
No,
you don't find him. You don't find him. You don't find Chad, right?
Did they find you?
No, I didn't get fined.
No,
I didn't get in trouble.
But people were saying he should be maybe, but he shouldn't be fined.
Yeah, that's just
slow.
Whenever you have that you're always going to have one side or the other.
Stu started it.
Yeah, Stu hit you pretty good.
Yeah.
He started it the turn before the finish.
Yeah.
You guys touched for like a couple laps, right?
Yeah, it was a good battle.
Mm-hmm. Is it so I meant to ask this earlier and something happened, but maybe this is like I walked uphill to school both ways when I was younger, you know what I mean? So maybe that's this, but the Stu Chad battles, they were pretty good. Like, they were good for our sport. They were good on the track. Yeah, I mean, Dungeon Villapoto, you're like, eh. You know?
Even Chad with Ricky, they were pretty good.
Well, okay, but are we just being biased towards, you know, our day?
I feel like...
you know what I mean? I don't know.
Like, there was games that you played back then, you know, like, and it was fun. Like, it was all part of, like, right. You know, like, they would say something and you'd try to come back so that you could have a little, you know, add yeah. a little something to it. And nowadays, it just seems like, you know, Dunge wasn't that kind of guy. He wasn't ever going to talk anything, you know, like, he was always just like, you know, like, hey, I tried hard, whatever.
Right.
He was better than me. And, like, there was just that vanilla
RV
feel about
too.
It.
RV was
yeah,
too.
And it's like, I don't know, just, and you think of, like, the RJ days, and, like, there was always this flavor there, you know? And
I think it's really
it's more calculated now. It's okay to take a loss now and regroup and see for next week or whatever. You hear all the riders say that. Oh, we did a top three. We'll see next week. You know, we're not the best tonight. They were the best. In all days, it was more like every race
was
we wanted to. When I was, you know, racing to win or whatever. Every race I wanted to win.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't settling. I think they settle a little more now, and they have less ego to do so than before. We were like, every race, even if we're not 100% and we don't like the track, we're going to try. And that's why, you know, you had ego, Bubba had ego, yeah. Ricky had egos, and then if you put those guys together, then you have fireworks.
I mean, I think that this day and age with the social media and everything like that, the rider directly sees, like, every time he makes a comment for good or bad,
yeah.
you see it. Like, it's like they either beat up on you or, like, they post stuff to you. Like,
right.
You know, like,
well, today Roxon said Cooper will never get his speed back.
Yeah. And, you know, media. And it's like, yeah, like, he makes it, like, and he doesn't even say it to the world. He just yeah. says it within his own
right.
group. Little, yeah. Yeah. you know, thing. And then yet it spirals to the point where, like, you know, actually, I think JT was the one that texted to me. What? I don't think he works, actually. Did he get a day off or something like that?
He's very social
yeah,
friendly.
Yeah, he's very social friendly. yeah. But it's like, you know, something like that, and it's blown out of proportion, and yeah. it's like there's more to the story, I think. But, you know, it's just yeah. funny that, like, nowadays I just think that's why everyone's so vanilla and just a little bit on the boring side.
What do you think, Timmy?
I was just going to say I hate the podium speeches.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think
my rock star, whatever, monster, just...
It's so lame.
But they have to say that, right?
It's no, just, you do. Like, you yeah. get asked to do it, and, you know, like, towards the end of the good era, like, I remember, I think I had, like, a $5,000 fine if I didn't thank Parts Unlimited and Thor.
Yeah.
You know? So, remember when we had a media day at Yamaha?
At Yamaha. They said, don't do that anymore. They used to say,
don't say Yamaha and list your sponsor. Just be talk. Personable.
And then now it's the opposite.
Remember like, we had media...
Have you heard... Here, I'll write down my team name and you try say that.
Yeah, Yamaha Services and like, Yamaha like, Lube. And, yeah.
And I mean, and hey, then, well, you know... And, so after Cooper messed right. it up in Seattle,
that, awesome.
That didn't go down good. And then now it
what
was
did
like,
he say? What did he say?
I think he, like, he halfway through it, he jacked it up and he says, oh, whatever. And, like,
whatever like my that. Team is, yeah. thank you.
Yeah.
And it says it right
that,
here.
That
right
didn't,
here.
That
Jack, Cooper really said that?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
you know, like, in 03, 04, we had media training.
Yeah.
And they told us not to thank Yamaha and Liz the sponsor, to be personable and then talk about right. the race and not really say
yeah.
team name and tires and everything. It's weird that they flip-flop that
now
much.
It's flip-flop. Like, they have, you know, now it's like, I mean, literally, Jimmy holds a,
yeah.
you know, like anytime you're on the podium or something, oh, Jimmy's holding geez. A pit board. And, like they're like, and it's a pit board that doesn't have logos on it. And it's just a blue pit board with white writing.
Yeah.
So it's so hard to read from.
The thing is if you're on the podium, they've been talking about you the entire
the
race.
Whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Plus,
and
you're sticking
it's on
up
your
whole
shirt,
jersey,
it's just,
you know?
JT, what do you think, though? Like, am I being a little bit uphill to school both ways and saying the Stu Reed and Carmichael, I left him out a little bit, but was that a better era, quote unquote, better?
No, I think it's I think it comes down to some hard feelings because I really don't think that Dunge and RV, just to pick those two, I don't think those two really hated each other
right.
so much or really disliked each other. Where there were years where, or a lot of years where Chad and RC really didn't like each other. Timmy and RC outdoors when they were battling really didn't like each other.
Chad and Stu really didn't like each other. Basically, Chad and everybody really didn't like each other.
He's right. Only, you can't argue with that.
I'm the only one that was. I'm the only one that's been through the that.
Yeah, that the, era, time. The whole thing, right?
Who do you got going now? I
mean, yeah, but RC and Stu did not like each other. Like, they didn't like each other.
You know
who?
RC and Stu
didn't
hate each other.
Oh yeah, that's what so, I mean. Like yeah. You're singling me out because I'm here, but like
I never broke a helmet with MC.
MC?
McGrath. He never turned the sprinkler on me when I rode.
That was Hanson. It was Hanson.
But, yeah, so you think
I never.
I'm blaming Hanson.
So, JT, you think it's more of, like, just a natural rivalry? Like we could get that again if Tomac and Baggett, say, just started hating each other.
Yeah, and I think Kenny is one of those guys that's not scared. If he was healthy right now and Eli was, you know, if Blake was riding well, and who knows how it all play out. But I think you need outspoken people, you know, and Dunge was never going to be that guy. He was just never going to put himself out there or say the wrong thing. So it becomes difficult to create rivalries when you have someone who's completely unwilling to put himself out there. Kenny, I mean, he's not scared. He'll fight people on social media that he doesn't even know, you know, and if he was in this battle and somebody to him, he would be right in there. So I think there's potential for it if Kenny can get back there and Blake and Eli and all these guys. But I just think it comes down to personality.
I think there's a younger audience that's probably paying a little more attention to it. I think we're just old.
You all.
Well, Eli's never going to. He's just not going to go there, you know. So just that's it. He's not.
He'll explode one day.
Maybe just pent up rage.
I'll just freak out.
Do you guys think we see Stu again, Timmy? Do we ever see Stu race again?
I don't think so.
Why? Why do you want to see him?
I know fans want to see him. Like my Twitter feed, emails.
He's one of the biggest ever. There's
nothing to prove, really.
Yeah. Why is he going to show us? He'll never show us better than what we saw.
Right. Chad, do you think he races again?
Maybe on-offs. Maybe.
Like straight rhythm.
It's hard to say never, right? But from everything that I hear, and it's kind of legit behind, you know, like what, you know, like people that have to deal with him, that knowing what I know there, then I say, no, yeah. I don't
think. I know the Alta Red Bull guys went out to his house for a photo shoot. He was going to ride a two-stroke. Should I not say it?
No, I'm not. That's the story.
Yeah, he was going to ride a two-stroke. He's going to ride a modern bike, and he's going to ride an Alta bike, and it was going to be a Red Bull video.
It was
going to be bitching.
Big deal, yeah.
Yeah.
And he
did. Alta drove out from Cali. He didn't show. So.
At his own, yeah.
I mean, that's a good indicator.
It was a long drive.
From Orlando.
This is like, you know, like when you hear things like that, then I find it hard to believe that he's going to come back. And.
But you can still make decent money just to do exhibition. Europe, maybe Australia, or.
Dude.
You can make almost like maybe $1 million riding like
it's totally different era.
5-6 races.
Dude, totally different era. But Dogger literally raced in Europe for like 3 years and made a ton of money when he was no longer racing Supercross.
You know, I raced a Dogger in 19.
He probably beat you.
90. I actually beat him.
If I didn't.
1994.
Yeah.
I was on the Cakes 125. It's like a international race.
I doubt you beat him.
And then he was on the Cakes 500. And I beat him the second moto. I was like, dude, that was insane. I was at 125. It was so weird.
Good story, bro.
F you, dude.
Great radio, bros.
I don't think we'll see him again, but we'll see.
So we just need some. We need Baggett and Tomac, JT, is what you're saying. They got to get at it because they've been Baggett's been saying some stuff, which is fine.
Yeah, you just need people that aren't scared to speak their mind, really.
Yeah.
I mean, that's.
Yeah, but you don't want to sound stupid, really. You know, that's.
Oh, I do.
There's a fine line between speaking your mind and sounding like an idiot.
Yeah, but JT says.
I want him to sound as dumb as possible.
That's great.
You're doing a good job.
He's great at it.
Jason Thomas here on the Pulpmx Show, presented by Fly Racing. Also, Grantstone Boots. We gave it to Henry Miller. We have a Pulpmx Show Privateer Hero Award. Henry Miller got it for blowing up a motor. Grantstoneboot.com. Please check them out. Instagram, Facebook. Whether you're at the office or traveling on the weekends, Grantstone has you covered. Why are you laughing at?
I've never even heard of that name before.
Well, it's a very top-notch, high-class boot company. Of course you wouldn't.
Doesn't have JTS something to do with that?
No, he doesn't have anything to do with it.
What?
What's the name?
Grandstone Boot.
Grandstone Boot. I never even heard of it.
JT's got a pair.
Is it actually a boot? Like a riding boot?
No. No, no. Oh. No.
He wants some after he's what boot did you wear? Scott boot?
Scott boot.
Oh, we don't want to talk about
that.
Got I
got him. I'll give them to you.
I got a pair in the garage.
Come up there.
I stand.
So what is this? So what is Grantstone boot?
JT, help him out.
It's like a leather, it's a leather shoes.
Casual shoe. Yeah.
Casual shoe. Leather shoes.
Shoe. Well, good. I hope they got more PR now.
That's the idea.
They're sponsoring the show.
I know. That's what I'm saying. We're still talking about.
That's literally why they're doing the show.
I'm going to look them up. I'll look them up right now.
Hey, JT, so for a long time, you rode at Timmy's house week in and week out. And for a long time, you rode at Chad's house. Both Timmy and Chad on their phones right now. But what was different about their programs and what was the same, in your opinion? And again, literally, this is – you rode with these guys 3 days a week, you know, 9 a.m, did your moat, you know, it was, you were in there, embedded in their camps.
Timmy was much more punctual than Chad.
Shocking.
Still am.
Yeah, I spent a lot of time on Chad's couch just sleeping and watching TV. didn't really know when he was coming out there.
But wait, why couldn't you ride? Was that the kind of the rule? Like, you can't ride to the...
No,
I'm not going to go. I don't want to go just ride. I mean, I'm there to, you know, I'm riding his track. I'm obviously going to wait for him. If he wants to ride at dark, I'm going to wait till dark.
Oh, okay. Sometimes it's brand new.
Yeah, but let's tell the real story.
Yeah, I thought I was.
No. This fool, yeah. Hey, JT used to go play poker and do all these little gambling things.
Uh-huh.
He'd be up to like 4 or 5 in the morning. Well, then he would just go straight from there to my shop and then literally sleep on my couch and wait for it. So
well,
let's not cloud
like
the
PM,
so. Let's not cloud the story. And it's, you know, you were a little bit, you're out late too.
Yeah, I mean, I was, but I don't think that had any relevance on whether you were.
I thought that that's why I was lapping
noon.
You so easy around the track.
No, that's just
lacking
that
some sleep.
I don't think it had anything.
Hey, JT,
to do with that.
Just tell him you jumped that one quad he never jumped.
I called bullshit. I did that.
I jumped a few out there.
He jumped a quad at my house. I never jumped too.
JT did.
Yep.
Jumped a quad.
Yeah,
he never did.
This is true. I've heard about it. Never seen it, but heard about it.
I saw it, and they did one at my house that I never did either.
Didn't it? It was like a quad, right?
It was
wasn't
right
it? Like out of a turn.
Yeah.
Didn't it go quad or something?
I'm impressed, JT. I did not know this. I did not hear this story.
The track leak got quickly changed after that.
These things hurt my ears.
Yeah, I think I was just trying to hurt myself. So
you have big ears, buddy.
I know.
What's that, JT?
I think I was just trying to hurt myself, so I'd put myself out of my own misery.
Oh.
Pack it in sooner.
Well, okay, Liz, back to the serious question, though. What was the different, what was the same?
No, I mean, obviously, you're talking about two of the, you know, best riders in the world at the time, so a lot of similarities as far as work ethic and all that. Timmy was super structured. You know, I think his program was like, we're gonna get there, we're going to do X, Y, Z, and then we're done. And Chad was like that on certain years, but mm-hmm. It depended on the year and the time. But Chad would be much more open to work on things, and the program kind of changed over time. So it was just, you know, subtle differences. But anytime you're talking about somebody at that high a level, that both of them were so dedicated to what they're doing, you're going to run into a lot of the same consistencies. And the same thing you would see from the guys now. I mean, Blake or Eli, I mean, they're so single-minded and focused on what they're doing that, you know, they wake up and that's the first thing on their mind. It's the last thing to think about before they go to bed. So it's hard to vary too much when you're dealing with somebody that with that much focus.
Timmy, before the season started in 2004, I went to your house. You were doing 320s, right?
Something like that, yeah.
Chad, were you doing that kind of, what were you doing for preseason stuff? How much would you ride?
Playing golf.
Yeah, playing golf.
That beat everybody.
Would you ride that much? Would you ramp it up before the year?
Hell no.
No.
Still only 1 hour.
No, I'm just trying to get to
He's so full of shit right now.
He would ride a lot.
I'm trying to get to the bottom of
it.
I've seen him do
30s and 25s. Yeah.
Yeah. I think which JT's can too. I think Chad had this ability to not ride for a while, go to Australia, come back, and then the first day, like, do 20 laps. Like,
right.
That was something for whatever reason, I just wasn't able to do on Supercross. Mm-hmm. Outdoors, I was fine.
I can come
it,
off
but...
the couch, I yeah. think, as good or better than anyone.
Yeah, no, for sure. Like, I would be riding, and then, okay, come over and ride. Okay, go over there, and he beat me in 20 laps.
Like, I hadn't.
I'm like, okay, great.
But I mean, yeah, I did, obviously, I had a structured pretty, you know, like, motos and stuff. But like JT said, like, you know, if there was certain ways that I was feeling or wanting to work on something, I wasn't, like, if I didn't get a 20 in, it didn't matter.
Yeah, you're,
like,
you're fine.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, geez, sometimes I would go into the season without even doing a 20, and my first 20 would be at the race. I mean,
really? Yeah. Are you being serious?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like, and just because I felt like that particular year I needed to work on another area.
Right. Well, DV was a bit like that. DV.
And I want to say that, like, 04 was, geez, 04, going into 04, I hadn't, I mean, you know, like, rewinding, I had shoulder surgery. So,
that's
like,
right,
six weeks before the race, I hadn't even rode a dirt bike. I only just started riding the week before Vegas. I mean, not Vegas, Anaheim 1. And then, so I was happy to be on a dirt bike, let alone, you know, competing. Yeah. So I did a lot of off the bike stuff, but not.
And DVU at your peak, you wouldn't do a lot of laps, huh? I mean, you would do sections, you would do fast laps.
I would do it like towards the end, though, only towards the end. But
before, like, coming up to Anaheim.
Yeah. Just not that much, though. Just
DVU was always, what I remember at least, is always just like single lap and double and two laps, and then like figuring out, like,
jumping from lane to lane,
and things like that. And I miss that, like. Having, you know, growing up in this era with, you know, these two guys, like, I felt like it was fun. Like, that was, like, nowadays, like, it's...
Dude, he was in the original Moto Triple X video.
Exactly.
That's how funny.
You know, like, nowadays, it's really, like, I feel like it's over-regimented, and it's just, you know, like, the fun's kind of sucked out of it a little bit.
The thing is...
At the end of the day, like, we're dirt bike guys that enjoy riding bikes, and...
Yeah, I have no idea. I have no clue, but I don't think Eli Tomac or Blake Baggett have fun. Well, maybe they do. I don't know. But
at some point, I'm sure they do. But I don't know. I don't know.
You know, I've been around a little bit the last couple of years. I've seen, like, people, like, getting ready for the Supercross, and I don't understand the concept of going to a track and do 20s and riding the same line at the same speed every day. You know, and when I was racing, I felt like, and I feel the same today. I think speed is the first thing you need to get. The rest is speed, obviously, and skills, because you have to be skilled to go fast, you know, especially in Supercross. Outdoors is a little different. But that's why I worked on my speed all the time. You know, find little thing, details, like, you know, corner speed, whoops, you know. And that's what I worked on. If you add all the fast lap I did during it one day, I maybe rode more than guys today that go and do a 225. I was riding more than 50 fast laps a day. Yes, they were not in a row, but you know, I was there. Everybody said, "Oh, you only did single laps," but they forgot that I might be did
was,
like
there was method,
you know,
behind it. Yeah,
yeah, I
he
maybe
didn't come
did
in for
like,
water.
He didn't.
No, I just no, like he got like on. Half
he'd,
a lap, mess
he'd,
it up,
he'd
start
stick,
again.
He'd stay
quarter
on.
Of a lap. Start again.
Stay on the face of the triple always.
Yeah. And then finally nail one.
I probably spent 7 to 10 days at RV's house in the 3-4 years that I was going there down in Florida. It was one time a year. I never saw the guy do anything but 20s and pull in and go home. Like, I never saw the guy do a warm-up half a lap. Do you know what I mean? Like,
when I was with helping Nick Way for a little bit at the carry truck, Nick called me and said, "Oh, come give me a few pointers or whatever." And then, RV comes, bike out. Alden was there. Alden goes on the triple. Doesn't even do a parade lap. Go around, the 20s, stop, 20s, home.
Yeah. I was always like, this guy's not having any fun. Like, I liked RV.
He's not
but
racing anymore.
No, right, really, right?
That was so weird. Like, not even a parade lap. Yeah. Pit ball right away, 220s, and it was done. Like, in 1 hour, his training was done. Like, when I was, like, the worst with my dad, dude, at 9 o'clock at the track on the bike, and I was leaving when the sun was behind the mountain around, like, 4.
That was Jimmy was making you there.
I was like, dude.
God, that's what we should have brought up with Jimmy, like, how long our test days were.
Jimmy, the track window is gone. Like, it is now like concrete.
Hey, but then, unfortunately, we would be there that long that the sun would go down behind the mountain, and then it would come back.
Good again, it would. We'd always wait to like do like a moto at the end, like the sun would go behind it.
And then you could do a moto, and the track would be badass.
Yeah. But you know, like, it's good where, because we rode a lot. You need to ride a lot. Yeah. You need to shoot threes when you play basketball a lot.
Yeah.
And I think now, guys, when you see, like, I don't follow anybody on social media, but sometimes I go and I check.
You unfollow Pookie.
I look at the rider list on Racer X, and the guys, I'm like, I don't know if they are at a vacation resort or if they're like actually racers.
Well, there's, you know? We got a whole new era of Instagram famous people.
Insta bangers. JT.
No, but it's not.
JT's on live.
I'm just one of, you know, that's the point. Like, right. I don't see people get out of the track at 9, leave at 4. I don't see it anymore.
No, I agree. JT, do you know, you're a big fan of Rocky movies, right?
Of what?
Rocky movies.
Rocky movies, yeah, of course.
Okay, so Apollo and Rocky were bitter enemies, correct? They had 2 fights against each other.
But one died.
And they were bitter enemies. And then JT, what happened in Rocky 3, JT?
They were hugging on the beach.
So, DV and Chad, once bitter rivals, now DV goes and coaches Chad.
Would never work.
So not like Rocky.
Yes, and Apollo died at one point. Yeah, that's the point.
We won't kill you, DV. So it'll just be.
Oh yeah, put me out of my misery. Anyway.
Question for you on the phone, JT from Tyler. Tyler, what's up, man? You got a question for JT Money?
Yeah. Hey. So I was paralyzed a few years back in Rupert, Idaho, and started racing again after one of those guys that straps in and stuff. And like the Mesquite MX track and some hard packed places like that has always been my favorite, obviously, that I can't ride the ruts like I used to. And I'm just moving out to Boise here in a week or two. And is there any tracks out there that you can say are similar to that, that don't seem to get beat up? I mean, I know you're in the area, so you'd probably be the best man to ask.
What do you think, JT? You know anything?
So OMC is probably the best track that's around, and depending on when you're riding it, it can be like that, but it's honestly, they could hold a national there, no problem, and it would be better than a few of the tracks we race on now.
Like big open
turns. There used to be a track right by our office that would have been perfect for you. I just don't know if they're back open yet. They've been open and closed a few times. If you want to send me an email, I'll send you the info on it and try to find out if they're back open. Because it keeps opening and closing, but honestly, that place would be perfect, and it's right by the airport and ideal for you. So just shoot me an email, and I'll follow up with you on it for sure.
Hey, appreciate it.
Awesome. Thanks, man. No thanks problem. For the call. Cheers, thanks for listening.
Hey, thanks.
Thank you. Timmy, what do you remember about JT practicing with him every day, day in and day out?
He would leave Gainesville, and he would eat Subway sandwich for breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And then he would get to my house before 9. Get his bike out. We would do some riding. He would eat a Subway and he would drive home.
And he had a sidekick.
T-Mobile.
Yeah, the sidekick for the longest time.
Oh,
yeah.
JT lived with a sidekick.
He would sit on the other side of Chad's garage.
I remember doing track watch. Yeah. He had iPhones. He had a sidekick still. Yeah. I'm like, wow.
JT, sidekick.
It was a strong offering from T-Mobile.
Do you still have it?
No, well, I do actually.
It's framed in his living room.
Yeah, I was gonna say you should frame that thing.
I like JT. JT had a really cool van.
there you go.
Hey,
JT memories.
I just want to know how many dirty filters you can have in one van.
Well, he would just throw them in there,
dude. Because he would just do bike prep and then like just you know literally throw the filter in there. I think. And then put his bike back in the thing, and then he'd wherever he went and stayed, and then he would jump back in, and then bike was ready to go the next day.
The bike never went in the garage. Yeah. Stayed in the van.
Dude, and then the stand. He had the worst stand. I actually think.
Yeah, I remember his stand. It was the old
it was
DG
like,
one.
Dude, it was like.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, it was scary. It was a danger. I think
yeah,
I was the one
that in,
I think I forced him to get a new one.
He did. Yeah, he bought it from me in 1995, and I raced with it, and had it till 2010 or 11, maybe. It held out.
Yeah. Dude, I think
so you had a stand for
it.
16 years.
Yeah. Same stand.
Same, yep. Dude, it was broken. It was like, it was so sketchy.
You could have got plenty of
We don't raise quitters around here.
The first time that JT ever came down the ride with me, he had like an S10 or something, single cab. And he's driving to my house, going to Tampa. It started raining, and he had no windshield wipers, and he's driving with his head out the window.
What? Can you verify this?
We were going to my Largo house.
Windshield wipers didn't work.
Yeah, he's. I look back in the mirror. And
he had his goggles on.
What year was that?
Yep. That's tough not to have.
That would have been 98.
98.
That's tough not to have wipers in Florida, like with the rainstorms in Florida.
Yeah. Well, and if it's not rainstorm, it's bugs.
Yeah. all right. Hey, let's talk a little High Point. Let's get back to that. 250 class, which we didn't touch on a little bit. Osborne, J-Mart 1-2-2-1 this weekend. Plessinger was very good after cutting his penis, cutting the head and the base of his penis in a practice crash and still finishing. So that was pretty good.
It's TMI, buddy. I don't want to talk about his penis.
Dude, I couldn't believe he raised. I'm like, holy shit.
That's a schlong shot.
But, hey, Timmy, favorite drop? Is that your favorite drop?
No, but it's his favorite. It's his favorite.
Hey, Mark, you swing both ways or what?
Sometimes it's just so fitting. You know?
Yeah, it fits right up there.
By the way, Fly Racing holding the red plate in both classes.
Really?
Chad, Fly Racing. Flyracing.com.
I mean, at some point they
What's that got to do with Chad?
Yeah, well,
just rubbing it in because Chad likes to take the little digs, you know.
Yeah, but.
He's a Fox guy.
I do that in person. Not to the world.
What do you think? What do you think, Red? Osborne, J-Mart, or somebody else?
What, for the championship?
Championship.
I'd probably go with Osborne right now, but I don't know.
J-Mart is still close to 20 points behind, right?
Mm. I don't know the points.
No, I don't think it's 20.
18? 18, maybe?
Yeah, you're right, actually. I think it is. Right.
It's 18.
Yeah, 18.
Yep. Well, it'd take away J-Mart's first moto DNF at Hangtown. His bike blew up. You know, be right there. I mean, you can't, but you know what I mean. What do you think, Chad? What do you like?
I think, you know, like, you'd like to think that J-Mart's been there and done it twice already.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't see the same J-Mart. Like once upon a time, I thought he was gnarly.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't seen that from him yet. So I don't know. I don't know if, like, he doesn't look as comfortable as what he once did. And, like, just that, I mean, God, I remember him in his Yamaha years.
He would blitz it. He would be gone.
Yeah, he was really just gnarly. And I think that guy wins, but I haven't seen that guy yet.
JT, what do you think?
It's interesting because I think what Chad was alluding to also is, and I don't know if it's even possible, but it's like he burned up his fitness level or something, like he overtrained himself or something, because
if I could add anything, I think he got so hung up, like everyone started talking about his, you know, his VO2 max. And it's like he has, from what I understand, really, really high VO2 max. But it's like, doesn't mean you're going to be, you know, a badass dirt bike rider either. You know, like there's people that have really low ones and
mine's not good.
They're awesome.
Yeah, but you have to, VO2 max, it's an average of stuff.
No, I'm well aware of what it is.
You have to be skinny, body fat small, and then
I just
strong.
Think I agree with what Jason's going on about right now. I just think that he's kind of like the beginning of the end was almost last year when we started, you know, he got sick and, you know, like whatever happened, like I think he went down a road that's tough for him to dig out of.
Yeah. Well, the one thing about sorry, JT, go ahead, finish your sentence. Yeah.
No, I was just saying I don't see the elite. He's obviously strong. Like you don't win outdoor nationals without being strong. But the fitness level that I saw like 3 years ago was so much higher than anyone in the class. It wasn't even comparable. And when I see him now, he's winning, but. Mm-hmm. He's vulnerable. He's beatable, you know, and I don't know what to attribute that to. I don't know what the difference is, but to me, it looks like he trained so hard for a few years and kind of blew himself up, and I don't know what it takes to get back to that, but I don't see it now, and I think he's working hard, but I still think he's much more vulnerable than he was, you know, when he was winning those two titles in a row.
Do you want to know what I think or no?
Yeah.
You were next. Here, DV.
Bring it.
You were next.
I think he's. He looks like a.
You probably know him. You got to see.
No, I wasn't really. I saw him a little bit with Christian, but I think he looks like a 40-year-old rider. I think.
Is it like Red Dog?
No, like me? I think I'm looking at you know, it's nothing bad, no disrespect or anything. His riding style, the way he rides, it looks like Barry Costin. It's like really tight, straight, no movement.
He's, so, no. He's pretty small.
Why would you think that was disrespectful? That doesn't sound disrespectful at all, that the guy, in, you know, two-time champion, that's second in points, like Barry Costin out there.
Not, but I think now he looks like he's really straight to his bike. He doesn't, there's no movement in his riding style. There's no scrubbing. He, you know, I tweeted about it. He looks like really, really, really stiff. No scrubbing. Yes, he's winning and he's national champ. But I really think there's something wrong with his riding. Maybe bike setup, because that seems like it's the world.
The bike doesn't look 100% like what it needs to be.
You know, he's not mobile on the bike. He doesn't try to. He's fast, but he could be so much better. He's like stuck in his ruts, and then he jumps straight. All the like step ups going towards the Braccio Boulevard, straight, no like. Scrub, yeah. Trying to go fast, weird, like elbow down. It's kind of, I think there's something wrong with riding style. I think fitness is there because he's right there. You know, I don't think he's, he got passed towards the end somewhere. Was it, what race was it? He got dropped a little bit at
first,
the end.
First moto this weekend.
Yeah, this moto. Yeah.
That was it?
Yeah. Osborne passed him. So we're all on the Osborne train, Zacho.
I'm not.
No?
But still, there's nothing. We're not talking about a RV, Bubba, a Ricky in the last class, like blowing everybody. It seems like those guys, they're the two best, it seems like. But I want to see maybe Dylan get a little more.
I'm waiting for Faulkner. I'm kind of waiting for Faulkner to start. Like last year, by the end of the Nationals, Faulkner was unbelievable.
Do you know, if you talking about fitness, the one guy that needs it is Plessinger, whatever you talk about.
He was good this weekend, but you're right.
Did you see like how he was good? Like whatever he starts, he finished pretty much the same. If he gets the top 8, 10 start, he gets third or fourth. He starts in front, he gets third or fourth. And this weekend, he was good at the beginning. Then he hit the wall so bad, I thought. Mm-hmm. And then at the end, he was strong. Caught up. You know, if he can, you know, keep that. And I really like his riding style because he's trying things. He gets out, change lines, work with the bike more. The two in front, they're not really doing that much. You know, Osborne is pinning it really strong. And but I like Plessinger, and even Dylan is same thing, kind of trying to find something to have creativity.
Likes the French guy.
But Aaron is not French, though.
No, true. All right, JT, anything else?
Yeah, whatever.
What are you doing on your birthday? Yeah.
Baguette or Tomac? Okay. We haven't asked him.
Yeah.
He likes Baguette.
He has
to say that?
I don't think.
Contracted?
Neither one of them would be a surprise at this point. Tomac was, I was 100% sure Tomac was going to win this title going into the season. So I would be silly if I said, you know.
I don't think there's one person that put a penny on Baguette before the season, though.
Really?
You think so?
I mean, from everything that you heard about testing and.
Yeah, there was some buzz for sure.
Like pre-Hangtown?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I actually think that Hangtown was a bit of a letdown for BB.
Yeah, it was. Absolutely.
Because before it was
8-6 wasn't anywhere near what anybody expected, I thought.
Yeah.
All right, buddy. Thanks for coming on. Happy birthday and everything. Thanks for the walk down memory lane. Pulpmx Show 300. You've been there for the whole time, man. So thank you. Thank you. A big part of why we made it to 300.
Have a good birthday, man.
All right, have
a kettle and water.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. See ya. All right, everybody, we're going to take our second commercial break of the night. We still have some more questions. We got a tear-off segment, and we're going to wrap this thing up. I'm still finishing the thing.
He's got to pee.
He's got to go. All right, everybody, so we're going to wrap this thing up, and we'll be right back with a little bit more on the Pulpmx Show 300, presented by btosports.com and Fly Racing. See you in a bit.
All of us have one thing in common. When it comes to leaning that bike into a corner, floating a dirt bike through the air, or blasting a sand berm in a UTV. And that is passion. At BTO Sports, our foundation is built around family, which allows us to offer unparalleled customer service. Knowing we share a common interest, we look forward to the weekend as much as you. So we offer 3-day express on orders over $85. BTOsports.com is proud to be a premier source for motorsports parts and apparel for well over a decade due to our reputation for excellent customer service and great prices. From motocross to mountain bikes, sports bikes to UTVs, BTOsports.com has what you need, because our passion reflects yours.
Yeah, that's right, people. That's Van Halen. I want to tell you about my two favorite things in life: Van Halen and fly racing. Flyracing.com, they make much more than just moto gear, mountain bike gear, gear, hard parts. They've got it. Flyracing.com. The F2 carbon helmet. It's as close to a factory bike as a helmet can get. It's out of the box and onto the racetrack ready helmet for guys like Millsaps, Baggett, Kennard, and Pike. Carbon fiber, Kevlar, Coolmax, MIPS. Fly Racing's F2 Carbon has 10 different graphic styles, 22 colorways. Go to your local dealer, get them from flyracing.com. Please check them out. A whole line of hard parts as well. Flyracing.com. Let's listen to some Van Halen.
Do you ride a stock bike? Then why drive a stock truck? Enfab offers innovative products to take your truck or Jeep to the next level. Innovative high-quality styles will let you customize your vehicle just like you customize your bike. The new RKR rails with patented detachable steps provide ease of entrance around town and clearance and protection for an off-highway adventure. Enfab's direct bolt-on MRDS pre-runner bumper with multi-mount and LED helps light up your world. Justin Barcia, Weston Pike, and Filthy Phil are all Enfab users and fans. Visit Enfab.com to learn about all of the innovative products and how you can outfit your build. Enfab. Get your truck in gear.
Randy Richardson from Michelin here, and I'd like to thank the Pulpmx show listeners for your support and share some information about Michelin motorcycle tires. Michelin offers motorcycle tires for everything from cruisers to sport touring, sport bikes, and adventure touring motorcycles. And as we celebrate our 10-year anniversary of our iconic partnership with Harley-Davidson, you'll find Michelin Scorcher tires on an increasing number of factory-equipped Harley-Davidson motorcycles. New for 2017, Michelin introduces the new benchmark for sport bike tires, the Michelin Power RS, featuring many of Michelin's patented technologies, all of which contribute to the incomparable grip, handling, and flickability of the Michelin Power RS.
I just want to hit a motocross stuff.
Fair enough. Let's focus on the Michelin Starcross 5. Because the Pulpmx show listeners are important to Michelin, we're going to continue to sponsor Steve's janky radio show.
That's right.
While I'm not like some people who say,
I know everything,
I do know a few things about motorcycle tires, and I'd like to share some of the key features and benefits of the Michelin Starcross 5 tires with you. And I promise it's not a bunch of corporate
blah, blah, blah.
The Michelin Starcross 5 tires are specifically designed for use in a broad range of conditions and terrain. They're available in sand, soft, medium, and hard versions, and are offered in 21 size and fitment applications.
Yeah, you like that?
In addition to the exceptional performance and durability, the redesigned architecture of the Michelin Starcross 5 features a bead profile that makes the tires easier to install. And everyone knows,
easier mounting, always a good feature.
If you're riding on Michelin Starcross 5 tires, but you have friends that are still buying other brands, please tell them,
No.
Encourage them to try a set of Michelin Starcross 5 tires. And if you haven't tried Michelin Starcross 5 tires yet,
you're out of your mind, dude.
Visit your local dealer or online retailer to purchase a set of Michelin Starcross 5 tires and install them on your bike. Who knows? They might just help you learn to do a backflip in a day. It worked for the Doom Goon. To learn more, visit MichelinMotorcycle.com and follow us on Instagram at Michelin Motorcycle.
Race Tech Suspension and Engines. Great guys. They've been with us for a number of years now. You know what Race Tech's all about. You know the top teams and privateers choose Race Tech. Look, maybe you don't race Supercross. I get it. That's fine. Neither do I. But you can at least get your suspension looked at. Change your oil. Change the bushings. Change the seals. Love your bike and it'll love you back. Pulpmx 17 is the code to save at racetech.com. Suspension and engines. Of course, they got their gold valves now. They got over 200 gold valve designs to date. They're constantly updating and evolving to provide the best suspension products and settings available on the market. 100% guaranteed to exceed your highest expectations. Love the guys at Racetech. Love what they've been doing for us. Love what they do for you jerkies. And we thank them. We're going to help you save, whether it's suspension or engine services. Just give your bike some love with some suspension. We'll do it. Racetech Gold Valves, 100% guaranteed to outperform your highest expectations. All Racetech products are made in the USA. Racetech Suspension and Engines. Make it happen. I like that. Make it happen. It's a good little tagline. Let me try it again. Racetech Suspension and Engines. Make it happen.
Attention, KTM riders. Need a little orange bling for your KTM? Maybe some cool new KTM power wear? Or just a few parts to freshen up your ride? Whatever you're looking for, KTM Parts Express is your place to shop. KTM Parts Express, the number one online source for all your KTM needs. With over 40 years' experience in the motorcycle industry, customer service is our specialty. Our warehouse is packed full of the latest KTM powerwear clothing, powerwear accessories, and genuine KTM replacement parts. Huge inventory, great prices, fast, accurate shipping. Use the code PULPMX to save 15% off your order. KTM Parts Express, the number one online source for all your KTM needs. For more than 20 years, Fortex Racing has been a leading manufacturer of MX race components, boasting intelligent race design. A proud supporter of the PulpMX show, Vortex is offering exclusive discounts for PulpMX listeners. Trusted by champions, Vortex Racing components are made from aerospace-grade billet aluminum to the tightest tolerances. Chad Reed and Cooper Webb of Factory Yamaha will be using our rear sprockets and will be rocking them for Supercross and Motocross. You'll find the right gearing for any track condition from the vast array of sprockets. Cat 5, F5, Hardcoat Silver, our long-lasting laser-cut steel Vortex sprocket. Our newly redesigned V3 Racing Chain 2.0 is the perfect complement to Vortex rear and front sprockets. Create a custom chain and sprocket kit with more than 30,000 possible gearing combinations. In addition to sprockets and chain, Vortex also offers the V3 MXSX handlebar that is 29% stronger than the competition. You can ride with confidence knowing that Vortex has put years of research, development, and testing into these super strong bars without sacrificing weight and speed. And that race teams like Team Babbitts use and abuse these bars on the national stage. And don't forget about your wearables parts. Vortex recently released its own line of V3 brake pads, V3 performance lines brake line kits, V3 oil filters, and V3 cycle straps tie-downs. Want 40% off your order? Just contact Jake at vortexracing.com or 800-440-3559 extension 222 and mention promo code PULPMX2017. For more information, check out vortexracing.com and see you at the track.
EK Chain set out to design a chain that was as elegant and beautiful as it was strong. The result is the 3D chain by EK. The first thing you'll notice about the 3D chain is its formed outer side plates. They have a curved form that helps to reduce weight. The centers of the plates have a recessed rectangular stamping that adds an eye-popping appeal. The inner side plates feature lightning holes and rounded edges to further reduce mass and put more power to the pavement. 3D chains by EK are available in three colors: chrome nickel, black gold, full gold. 3D's elegance is matched only by its strength, 11,400 pounds of tensile strength to be exact. That's enough to handle any motorcycle, no matter the terrain. The QX2 X-rings that are featured in the 3D chain have a better wear resistance than standard QX rings by 30%. This more efficient design results in a chain that transfers 1% more power and torque to the rear wheel. EK is accepting applications for rider support. Get your 3D chain by EK at a great price through the EK Rider Shop. To apply, visit ekchainusa.com and click on Rider Support.
WUSA is the number one source for quality wheel sets and wheel building services. They are the exclusive importer for Talon and Kite Hubs, along with DID and Excel rims. Their wheels and wheel building services are trusted by the finest teams in the country. Teams like Factory KTM, JD Suzuki. Rocky Mountain MCKTM, Rockstar Husky Star Racing, Monster Energy Babbitts. They all trust of ya. No job is too big or too small. WUSA, everybody, we thank those guys for coming on board with us. Whatever you need for your wheels, hubs, wheel building services, they've got it. Mention Pulpmx when you call down there, and they'll give you a discount. They ship nationwide. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram at WUSA.com. WUSA, they're all things wheels. Do it. WUSA. Do it.
Guts Racing, the leaders of seat technology, has tons of new stuff for 2017. Guts Racing has new products like RCH Factory Suzuki Graphic Kits and complete Husqvarna seats. Guts Racing has added new gripper material colors, fluorescent yellow and pink, to go with 9 other colors we already have. Guts Racing even expanded to more teams and riders. 2017 Guts Racing will be seen on JGR MX, RCH Suzuki, Factory Husqvarna, Cycle Trader Yamaha, Blue Buffalo, Barn Pros, MCR Honda, Pro Circuit Kawasaki, Malcolm Stewart, and many, many more top teams and riders. Guts Racing has the world covered for 2017 and beyond. So now it's time you join the Guts Racing team by using discount code PULPMX2017 for 30% off at GutsRacing.com.
Founded in 1999, PivotWorks was created with the vision of providing a fast, easy, and complete solution to maintaining the suspension and chassis of your dirt bike or ATV. By taking all of the hard-to-find parts within the different chassis and suspension segments and packaging them into one easy-to-order kit, PivotWorks helps simplify the way you buy dirt bike parts. You can save time and money by ordering a PivotWorks swing arm or linkage rebuild kit that contains all of the necessary parts for a complete rebuild. Whether it's wheel bearings or a complete shock rebuild kit, PivotWorks has what you need to get your bike or ATV handling like new for a fraction of the price of the OEM parts. If you race, ride for fun, or just like restoring bikes like Mathis, PivotWorks should be your first choice when it comes to bearing and seal replacement. After almost 20 years in business, PivotWorks is still the leader in OEM quality aftermarket bearing and seal kits. And PivotWorks is giving back to Pulp MX listeners by offering a special 30% discount for all orders placed online. Go to PivotWorks.com today and use the discount code PulpShow2017 for a 30% discount on your order. Ride hard, ride fast, ride PivotWorks.
Attention riders, welcome to Atlas Air Flight 604 with nonstop service to a better neck brace. Please follow along as we outline the safety features of this revolutionary device. Located on the underside of the frame is a convenient, easy open system. To fasten, simply insert the release bar into the left frame. To release, push the release button and pull the frame apart. We suggest that you keep your neck brace fastened throughout the duration of the moto, as you may experience an unexpected huckabuck from time to time. To ensure a safe ride, please keep your neck underextended at all times. In the likely event of an over-the-bars emergency, your brace will double as a suspension system. Although the Atlas brace will not be noticeable, it will be there when you need it. If you are riding with a child or someone who requires assistance, secure your brace first and then assist the other person with a Prodigy, Tyke, or Broll. We ask that you keep your brace on until your moto is finished. Maximum surface area is located on your chest around the sternum, back around the spine, and up over your shoulders with extra padding over your collarbone. Should you need more, please request a Defender Roost Guard or Guardian Body Armor. We remind you that this is a non-rigid neck brace. Tampering with, disabling, or destroying the product is prohibited by the limited lifetime warranty. You will find this and all other safety information in the user manual located online at atlasbrace.com. At this time, we ask that you remain standing with throttles in the wide open position, elbows up, and two fingers on the clutch. On behalf of the captain and entire crew, thank you for flying Atlas Air. Enjoy the ride.
Gear Alloy Wheels. Since introduced in 2004, the Gear Alloy brand has dominated the truck, SUV, and Jeep market with a wide range of styles, sizes, and finishes. Featuring unique, aggressive off-road styles, along with fashion-forward SUV styling for today's discriminating sport truck and off-road vehicle enthusiasts alike. Designed and engineered in SoCal in order to stay on trend with design. And sourced worldwide to ensure the highest quality, best-looking product available. With styles available in 16-inch through 22-inch diameters and 5, 6, and 8 lug applications, including 10-inch and 12-inch wide options. Whether you drive a Ford, Chevy, GMC, Dodge, Ram, Toyota, Nissan, or Jeep, there is a Gear Alloy wheel style for you with 20 different wheel styles to choose from in black, machined, milled, and chrome-plated finishes. Gear Alloy is a proud sponsor of the NFAB and Pro Yamaha GNCC race team and has been a longtime supporter of seven-time WMX champion and X Games athlete Jessica Patterson. Be sure to check out all the Gear Alloy wheels at gearalloy.com or atdwheels.com. Get your trucking gear.
Starting now, you can use the code PULPMX17 to save on Gear Alloy at SoCalSuperTrucks.com.
Gear Alloy wheels for your Jeep, truck, or SUV. Get your trucking gear.
Established in Northern California in 1989, Works Connection's original idea to bring top-shelf motocross and supercross products to market still holds true today. Offering protection and performance upgrades in the form of either aluminum or plastic skid plates, the patented ProLaunch Start device, radiator-saving radiator braces, or the unique tack hour meter with maintenance timer, being just a few of the product choices Works Connection stocks. Tested and trusted by RCH Racing, JGR Suzuki, Star Racing, Rock River Yamaha, and Babbitt's Kawasaki, you can count on Works Connection to provide reliable products that deliver. Available on the web at worksconnection.com or your local retailer.
Oh,
Welcome back, everybody. Pulpmx Show presented by Fly Racing and BTOSports.com. David Villeman, Chad Reed, Tim Ferry in studio. BTOSports.com, Fly Racing, NFAB Jeep and Truck Parts, Race Tech Suspension and Engines, Vortex Racing, Gear Alloy, Roost MX, Pivot Works, X Brand Goggles, Michelin Starcross 5, Works Connection, FMF, Atlas Neck Brace, W Wheels, EK Chains, Guts Racing, Ride Engineering, Grantstone Boots on with us tonight, and Get Data, something that Chad Reed uses. Chad, the Get system, you're a fan of it. Works pretty well for you.
I am a fan. It's you know, going back to 2011 when I was running my own team. You know, it's when you're competing against the factories and what they have available to them. Get is the next best thing for sure. So. It's currently the only thing available that I would.
What about when Alex Ray had it on his cycle trader and he just said it's too many lights for him?
Too many lights?
Yes.
See, I have a like window tint on mine, okay. Because I had it was the same problem. And it, you know what? You know, like we only ride in the daytime.
Yeah.
And then I show up at Anaheim and I'm doing a start and then suddenly there's just all this blue lights flashing at me and I'm like, what's going on? So it was funny. And then I had window tint put on it and I never had a problem with it.
Get Racing, destroy the start with Get. Same system that Chad Reed, Cooper Webb use as well as the JGR Suzuki guys. The NFAB JGR Suzuki check-in, n-fab.com, proudly built in Houston, Texas, USA. Jeep, truck, and SUV parts. I didn't talk to somebody from JGR this week because it didn't go well. Barsha hit his head and crashed and in practice didn't race. And Pike pulled out of the second moto. Cunningham had an okay day on the JGR 250F Suzuki. But, so the n-fab.com JGR Suzuki check-in is – that's it.
That, I didn't know what happened to Barsha.
Crash hit his head.
Oh, okay. So. No, I looked in the results and I didn't see him and I was – didn't know what happened.
Do you want to confirm or deny any rumors of you talking to JGR for next year? Is there anything you would like to confirm or deny?
No, I don't confirm or I don't deny.
Or deny anything? All right. It's been a rough year for those guys, and usually every week I try to catch up with the team, but they were really far parked, too, at High Point.
Long walk.
Dude.
Oh, like the lower – way. The Suzuki has always been down that lower tier.
And at the back of that lower tier. Like –
like, if it rains, you ain't getting out for 2 days.
Yeah, you're screwed. Let's get to Skippy on the phone. Skippy, what's up, man? How are you?
Doing pretty good, guys. How are you all?
Good. What's going on?
Not too much. So, at one point, actually, I'm glad you touched up on this, Chad. I had owned a 03 YZ250s and also an 09, and it was the first two strokes I owned since I had moved up to big bikes. Like, I just went straight to 250F kind of thing. And on sand tracks, I didn't really notice a big difference, but on hard pack, I noticed a huge difference, and I really actually preferred the 03 frames. And my 09 motors and 03s would swap over from aluminum frame to steel frame. They're all bolted up the same, and so when I blow one up, I just swap one to whatever chassis I was running that weekend. But I was just wondering, with you not liking the 05 as much, did you have any experiences on the 06s and stuff? You rode a 06 250s, didn't you, Chad?
No, we went four-stroke in 06.
You're 450s that year, huh? Okay, my bad.
Yeah, 05 was last year. Difference? We were two-stroke.
What was the biggest difference on what you felt? I'd imagine with Supercross being more hard-packed, was it just because the steel frame flexed a lot more, or what was it?
Hard to say, like, exactly.
You got to remember, too, how different our bikes are than what a stock one is.
I guess the more hard thing, I'm currently a Yamaha employee, probably is the hardest thing. So the hardest thing really, like, I mean, I didn't prefer the aluminum over the steel, but honestly, like, what I'm most excited about, I guess I would take it, is I'm more excited about riding the aluminum frame with a lot of the things that learned over the last 14 years, and I think that could really help that particular chassis. You know, we only rode it the 1 year, so it was kind of one and done. We didn't really try anything. You know, I've learned that the swing arms are different, so that's the first thing I want to try on it. So yeah, little things like that, you know. So but definitely a weight. I mean, Mathis will, you know, we had to add weight to our bike and
in 2005.
Really?
In the pivot both
yeah,
had lead in it.
Yeah, because we didn't, what was it, 216 back then? We didn't make the weight limit.
Nope.
I remember that I had a skid plate at one point that was really, really heavy.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think, you know, like they definitely achieved the weight that they wanted to. Wow. It was just a feel that we, that I think that is achievable now in what, you know, what we've learned over the years.
Thanks for the call, man.
Sure.
Appreciate it. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, guys. Y'all have a good one, man.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Pulpmx Show 300. We made it. Couldn't believe it. Wow. Dark Side, you got a question for the great Timmy Ferry, Summercross and defending Summercross champion.
Yeah, I got one.
You are.
Ferry, you had the pleasure of having one of the best mechanics to ever live.
That's right. Fourth best
wrench
mechanic he had. Fourth best.
First shift. So I want to know what Mathis did that was like the best. What was the best? What was he best at? And maybe what was his, if he had anything that he did that wasn't great, what was that?
Lunch
shortcoming.
I would say the biggest thing was that he was kind of out for me and he wasn't corporate. And
oh, I got in trouble too.
I know.
Oh, Keith got mad at me a couple times.
I think that's what kind of.
I thought he was going to punch me.
Yeah. I know. I think that's kind of like what every rider is kind of always looking for, is somebody that they mesh well with.
Yeah, you were mad at Chad, so I got mad at Chad.
Really?
Yeah.
You're weird.
I'm like, oh, we don't like Chad? No. All right, cool.
No. I don't want – not that kind of back.
No,
but you know,
that's how I was, though.
I feel like
bit.
That's how it used to be, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It used to be like
– yeah.
Sorry to crush it.
No,
like,
it's – yeah.
Like, there was invested – like, everybody was invested in – winning and doing better, and now it's just it's become that real political, like their mechanics and
the team versus the riders a little bit. Yeah, no, I agree with that 100%.
Yeah, I,